Very good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. There are no apologies this morning and Pauline McNeill is joining us online. So our first item of business is to decide whether to take item 7 on the agenda in private and also whether to consider the oral evidence heard and any draft letters on our pre-budget scrutiny in private at future meetings. Are we all agreed? Great, thank you. So our next item of business is to consider an affirmative statutory instrument. That's the draft Scottish Biometrics Commissioner Act of 2020, the Code of Practice Appointed Day Scotland Regulations of 2022, and I refer members to paper 1. This SSI specifies the day appointed for the coming into effect of the Code of Practice prepared by the Scottish Biometrics Commissioner under Section 7 of the Scottish Biometrics Commissioner Act of 2020. And I welcome Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, to the meeting and his officials. Ms Elaine Hamilton, our Forensic Policy Team Leader of the Police Workforce Equality and Forensics, and Mr David Scott, Policy Manager for Police Workforce Equality and Forensics, both with the Scottish Government. So I welcome you all this morning. So can I just start off by inviting Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement on the SSI.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to speak briefly about the Scottish Biometrics Commissioner Act 2020 Code of Practice Appointed Day Regulations 2022. You'll know that in March 2020, the Parliament passed the Scottish Biometrics Commissioner Act, and the legislation speaks to some of the key societal issues of our time. So it touches on data protection, privacy, human rights and ethics as they relate to the use by the police of very personal information. The Scottish Government therefore welcomed the Parliament's appointment of Dr Brian Plastow as Scotland's first Biometrics Commissioner in April last year. And given the rapid increase in the use of biometric data and technologies, it is important that we have an independent commissioner who will raise public awareness about rights, responsibilities and standards, as well as monitoring compliance with such standards. And it's vital that a clearer understanding of these issues is promoted in our communities, especially for young people and for vulnerable people. An integral part of the legislation was for the commissioner to prepare a code of practice. And that code has been prepared by the commissioner and it symbolises Scotland's, I believe, a progressive approach to biometrics in a policing context. It's worth mentioning this is the first code of its kind in the world. It's designed to promote good practice, transparency and accountability by setting out an agreed framework of standards for professional decision-making. It's intended to strike the right balance between the needs and responsibilities of policing and the criminal justice system and the fundamental obligation to guarantee the basic human rights, privacy and freedoms of individual members of the public. The Commissioner's developed a draft code in consultation with key interests, including those bodies subject to the code, as well as statutory consultees and other bodies represented on the Commissioner's advisory group. And I'm aware the committee has also had the opportunity earlier this year to consider a draft of the code alongside taking evidence from the Commissioner. And I know that the contents of the draft code were viewed positively by committee members. So the purpose of this instrument is to bring the code into force on the appointed day, and as agreed with the Commissioner, the day proposed is the 16th of November 2022. And from that day, Police Scotland, the Scottish Police Authority and the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner will be required to comply with the code. The commencement of the code will therefore represent a major milestone in the implementation of the 2020 Act. The Scottish Government is happy to work with the Commissioner and other partners going forward to ensure that an ethical, proportionate and lawful approach continues to be taken in relation to the collection, use, retention and disposal of biometric data in Scotland for policing and for criminal justice purposes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So I'll now open it up to members if you've got any questions on the instrument. Just... Okay, thank you very much. In that case, we'll now move to the next agenda item, and I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion number 05906 in his name, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the Scottish Biometrics Commissioner Act 2020 Code of Practice Appointed Day Scotland Regulations of 2022 be approved.
Move, Convener.
Thank you very much. So the question is that motion number 05906 in the name of Keith Brown be agreed. Are we all agreed? Agreed. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for attending. And that concludes our consideration of the SSI. And we'll just have a short pause to let the Cabinet Secretary and his colleagues leave the room. Thank you very much indeed. So our next agenda item is consideration of the following negative instrument, and that's the Judicial Appointments Board for Scotland Membership Modification Order of 2022, and that's SSI number 268 of 2022. And I refer members to paper number 2. So do any members have any questions on the instrument? Okay, thank you very much. Are members content not to make any recommendations to the Parliament on this instrument? Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for that. So we'll now just have a short suspension to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you very much. So our next item of business is our first oral evidence taking session on pre-budget scrutiny of the Scottish Government's forthcoming budget for 2023 to 2024. Submissions received from our call for views are now published on the committee's webpage, and submissions from the witnesses before us today are included in the papers for this meeting, and I refer members to papers 3 and 4. And we'll hear from two panels of witnesses today representing policing and fire and rescue services. So can I extend a warm welcome to our first panel to the meeting. So Ms Lynn Brown, Chief Executive of the Scottish Police Authority, Mr David Page, Deputy Chief Officer, and James Gray, Chief Financial Officer with Police Scotland. So a warm welcome to you all. So we'll move straight on to questions, if I may. And if I may just open up with a very general question. Might just be helpful in the current circumstances around sort of a very difficult financial climate. Perhaps before dealing with any specific implications of the indicative flat cash settlement announced by the Scottish Government, if perhaps you would like to share just a very initial overview of the Scottish Government's proposals. I appreciate this might be quite difficult, but I'll maybe just come to you initially, David, and then I'll bring in Lynn and James. So over to you, David.
Thank you, Kavina, and good morning, panel members, or committee members, I should say. We're obviously very surprised with the removal of real terms protection. In terms of what we've been doing in terms of the planning for the RSR, which is what we have to do in terms of planning for our budget, we've looked at the requirements that were laid out in the RSR, which we fully understand in terms of the challenges of public sector, in terms of across the whole of the public sector. What was asked for in Yara SAR was that public sector bodies should be looking to deliver public sector transformation, reduce headcount to pre-COVID levels, and to try and make those efficiencies to try and alleviate some of the pressures. One of the huge challenges for us in policing is that obviously we've delivered successfully now one of the biggest public sector transformations in the UK, let alone in Scotland. The merger of the 8 police forces and the 2 other bodies into a single Police Scotland did not come without a lot of challenges, as members will be aware, but we have delivered £200 million per annum of savings, and we have delivered improved services. That's not been without a huge amount of pain and a huge amount of stress and pressure, if you like, on our staff, but we are delivering a much better service. And if you look at Police Scotland delivery of service now compared to our kind of peer groups, if you like, in England and Wales, our transformation has been successful. We only have a non-pay budget of 13%, £176 million. So the vast majority of our budget is people. So any kind of requirement to try and bring more efficiencies to deal with a flat cash settlement falls squarely onto the people, to the officers and staff that work within Police Scotland. We push hard, we continue to push hard to deliver more efficiencies in Police Scotland. That journey never stops. And in terms of the transformation journey of Police Scotland, that is far from complete. Although we've delivered a huge amount of transformation in terms of cost reduction and in terms of some of the kind of technology improvements we've delivered in the past, we are still far from complete in that journey. We asked for in 2017 about £300 million to kind of deliver the digital transformation of bringing 8 police forces into a single platform and making it digitally enabled to allow us to compete with, if you like, organised crime and other threats. That journey is far from complete. We've mentioned in the past, and it has been mentioned by Dame Ailish, Angelini and others, the requirement for things like national body-worn video, which every force in England and Wales has. In fact, every force in England and Wales is moving through to their second generation body-worn videos. We don't have a national capability in terms of body-worn video. It's a key example of the types of transformation that still needs to be done by Police Scotland. So we've delivered on the bulk of the transformation activities that would make us more efficient. We've still got a long way to go, and we will still push into that space. But looking at a flat cash settlement, where we've got to in terms of our analysis is that we're left with a choice of either no pay rises going forwards or a pay freeze effectively for officers and staff, or we fund it ourselves. We basically cannibalise policing to pay for policing. The cost of that, because of our 86% of our people, our budget's people, is basically for every 1% is going to cost us about £11 million. So if we're looking at a 5% pay rise, which is what we provided to officers and staff and was accepted for this year, that would be £11 million, which is equated to about 225 staff. And that's officers and staff, because obviously it would fall equally on the workforce. It would fall disproportionately higher on officers, because obviously we have a lot more officers than we do in staff. And if you look at it from another perspective, the attrition rate of our staff is much lower than the attrition rate of our officers. So it would be officers that would take the hardest part of that. We have discussed informally with our union colleagues and with Federation colleagues about if we were to adopt a pay freeze situation over the next 4 years to try and protect the service that we have at the moment, what would be their position on that? Understandably, both have reacted quite strongly to that informally, that they would not accept it, that we could anticipate quite severe industrial potential strike action on the staff side. And we all know where we were in the run-up to the pay settlement with police officers this year. So we would, it's our intention, the Chief Constable's intention, to discuss with the board about the requirement to ensure that we do provide our workforce with a living pay rise as we go through the next 3 or 4 years. We've modelled that, as we've said, a 5% pay rise. We're not saying it would be 5%. We're just saying a 5% indicative pay rise, which is what we gave for this year, over the next 4 years, would cost us around £220 million, £222 million. That would equate to a reduction of just over 4,400 officers and staff. Now, we know that the RSR has been kind of given to us as a planning guide, and it is not a budget. We've been quite clear that if it was to translate into a budget, that's the sort of impact it would have on policing. So we've laid out the maths, if you like, of the impact of an RSR-based budget onto policing. The effect on policing would change Police Scotland from what we are at the moment, which personally, and I know officers and staff feel, is probably one of the better police forces in the UK. Police reform delivered a really good example of what policing should look like. If you look at England and Wales with the 43 forces, there's been numerous papers written about the fact that they're inefficient in terms of the way they operate. They should be kind of merging them, bringing them together, regionalising things, which is what you need to do to achieve cost efficiency and better service delivery. We've done that in Scotland. We have a service now that is £200 million cheaper and actually delivers things like a really effective COVID pandemic policing model that delivered COP26, which is, you know, the biggest policing operation the UK has ever had. And we delivered that better than anyone else could do and did on the ground. We reacted extremely well to Operation Unicorn with Her Majesty the Queen's death. We stood that up at very short notice and delivered it very successfully. So we've been able to manage these incredibly complex and very, very large operations at very short notice because we have a really efficient police force. Our problem is if we have to reduce the numbers, we lose that capacity and we'll become much more reliant on England and Wales for mutual aid to kind of dig us out of holes which we won't be able to police ourselves. I mean, we obviously have to use mutual aid at the moment because of the scale of some of these things, but our reliance on England and Wales will become much, much, much heavier. Secondly, because of the cut in capital and the threat to reform funding, the ability for us to continue to develop the technology capability in Police Scotland will be halted effectively. Now, what you usually do if you're being squeezed in an organisation around your people resources, you offset that pressure by using technology. If we haven't got the money for technology and we're losing our people, all that happens is you degrade the service. So that's a direction of travel that we are fearful of for Police Scotland if the RSR dictates the shape of our budget for next year. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, David. I'll just bring in, I think members will have follow-up questions on this sort of initial opening topic, but I'll bring in Lynn and then James.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. The authority is aware that in the financial challenges that the government face, they have to make choices. And they've set out in the RSR what those choices are. Our ask is that they rethink that in terms of flat cash for the police, and also that they recognise that the reform that police has delivered cannot be a reset. We have taken it forward. We would like to do more, and we'd like some investment to do that. So our ask today is that there's a rethink of that choice, and they choose to support police. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you for that. James.
Thank you, Convener. Two or three points for me. I think that the first one is around the uncertainty, to be honest. So we know the RSR was published on the 31st of May. There were a number of planning assumptions around inflation at that point, and clearly events have kind of overtaken, I think, what was the expectation. So real terms protection was dropped and replaced with flat cash as a planning assumption. Now, flat cash in a stable environment of 2% inflation is something that becomes more manageable. But when you're running with inflation at 10% currently and next year probably still likely to be high and uncertainty beyond that, I think really it's quite difficult to have any kind of certainty over medium-term planning. But if you look at the year ahead, which is now only just over 5 months away, I mean, we have an acute issue, I suppose, in relation to that, if flat cash becomes what the settlement is for policing next year. The DCO has set out the point around pay awards. So just to clarify, a 5% pay award, £55 million, that's the equivalent of 1,125 officers and staff And that's something that we'd need to have in place by April in order to afford a pay award if it was to be that level. But again, that's indicative because we don't know where we will be with pay next year. The other acute issue is around the non-pay and in particular the estate. So we've been doing the budget work for next year. It's still in draft, so these figures are indicative. But our current estate's budget is about £60 million a year to run around 300 buildings, which is all the call centres, the stations, the custody suites and so on. Now, we're looking next year at a pressure after we've applied savings around, you know, good practice around building energy management systems and putting in more solar panels and reducing temperatures in buildings. So everything that we can reasonably do, changing behaviours around the use of energy, we've still got a £9 million pressure on that £60 million budget. And that's 5 months away from now. So that's a real acute issue. How do you take 15% out of your budget? Yeah. So how do you take 15% out of that budget in 5 months' time in order to manage in a flat cash allocation? So we've got some really, really deep concerns around what flat cash would mean for us in the short term. But over the medium term, as the DCO said, it's the degrading impact of the compounded year on year on year that would obviously be of real significant concern to us.
Mm-hmm. Thanks very much. That's very helpful. So I'll now just move straight on to members' questions. I think perhaps, Jamie, you've maybe got a follow-up for this initial one.
Yes, or, yeah. Thank you. Good morning. First of all, it's important to put on record our thanks as a committee and members to officers and staff from Police Scotland who do an incredible job. That being said, just to sum up your opening statement, Mr. Page, it sounds to me like the choice facing you, if the SR comes to fruition and you are offered a flat cash settlement, is you have two simple choices. One is a pay freeze for 5 years and the implications that that has. Sounds to me like you've written that off as an option. It's just not doable because of the effect that that might have, or and indeed the resistance that you'll be met with. And the other option is to offer some form of annual pay rise to staff and officers. Modelling on 5%, to be correct, that would equate to a loss of 4,400 staff over 5 years. So my first question is, A, that sounds quite a lot. What effect would that have on your ability to perform both basic statutory functions as a police force, notwithstanding any additional upgrades and investment projects that you have or may have to shelve? I'm talking about your core work in protecting the public and responding as a first response body to the needs of the public. And secondly, that's modelled on 5%. If that number was to increase as a result of industrial conversations, disputes or action, then would that 4,500 go up and by how much?
Thank you for the question. The 4,400 number is over 4 years, effectively, terms of the end of the spending review period. The Chief Constable and the Force Executive are modelling the impacts of the types of workforce reduction aligned with a lack of transformational capability enhancement. We're looking at things like having to pull back from the types of policing that we do at the moment, because we won't have bodies to do it, to be quite frank. So things like community policing, campus cops, which incidents do we attend in terms of roads policing, pretty much the well-being, mental well-being, things like that. Because one of the other things that we are very concerned with is, and as Lynn has already said, we're acutely aware of the pressures on other parts of the public sector, local government. What has happened in the past has been that when services are withdrawn, people still need them. People still need to pick up a phone and get help. And what happens if the kind of other services are being withdrawn, because they're suffering from funding cuts, then we pick up the slack. And our problem there, of course, is as our demand is increasing because we're picking up increasing slack, our resource is reducing. Our ability to answer 999 calls, you know, it will be slowed. The 101 service, do we continue with that? If we don't continue with the 101 service, all that will do is shift people into dialing 999, who who would have previously dealt 101. If you've got more people dealing 999, what will happen then is that it'll be longer for you to get through and longer for us to respond. Response policing, digital forensics, public protection, all of those areas will be squeezed. There's a real concern that we won't be able to discharge our duties as A, we currently do. We provide one of the best policing services, if not in the UK, in the world. Our officers are part of our communities. You start to lose that. Our clear-up rates are good. They could be better. They could always be better. But part of that's because of the engagement with our communities. You know, you don't want Police Scotland to become a kind of a law enforcement, almost like quasi-paramilitary force, where all you can deal with is the most serious incidents. That's not what Police Scotland was intended to be. It's not what our officers and staff joined Police Scotland to do. You know, they're focused on the well-being of communities. They're focused on helping kids in schools, helping councils, helping vulnerable people. All of those things would be at risk.
I mean, is that, how much of this is, you know, you putting on a face to show a strong message to government that a flat cash settlement is simply on? Is it realistic that you would be closing down the 101 service? Is it realistic that you would have to pick and choose which call-outs you attend? Would it actually be a reality that 999 calls would either be delayed in answering, not responded to, or not answered at all? I mean, is that a reality, or is this just, a sort of...
Well, what's interesting for me and for Police Scotland now is we've got a really good grip of our finances. The last 5, 6, 7 years, you know, we're managing it to the penny effectively. So what we've done, looking at the RSR translating into budget, is we've done the math effectively. We've laid out all of the options. It's to the Chief Constable to determine how that would affect how the operational service delivery of policing. So all we've done is effectively laid out the kind of the mathematical consequences and what would be happening in terms of force police service reductions. It's for the Chief Constable at that point to try and juggle that. Where do I put my resources? So all of the things I've touched on are all the things that are under consideration. Mm. A lot of it depends on threat, risk and harm at the point. So, and again, the Chief Constable's been clear about this. If you look at where we are today as a society, you look at the disruption that we've had in the UK around the direction of politics, potential future referendum, social cohesion, inflation, Ukraine, increase in digital threats through organised crime, that's a very choppy ride in the future. So you want a strong police force to kind of help glue society together. So the Chief Constable is very concerned about where do we put limited resource when the threat's increasing. So I wouldn't speak for the Chief, but the maths give him some very, very difficult decisions to make.
Okay, I'll let others come in.
Thanks very much. Jim, do you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. It was just to make a point similar to the DCO around, what will it look like? I mean, it's worth reminding ourselves, and it's on page 7 of the written submission, that the police service, through reform, has reduced its cost base by 20%. Now, that's a similar amount to the reductions that we've seen in England and Wales over the same kind of period, and obviously that's now being reversed through the increase of 20,000 officers. But that's maybe a place to look at as well around, what was the impact in England and Wales around that? Because what we're facing now over the next 4 years is broadly another 20% reduction on top of what's already been delivered through reform. It was done through reform and there's been service improvement. So that's been a real, real positive. But once you've had that service improvement, yes, we might be able to get 1-2% efficiency a year. And that's what we're doing and focused on. This year, we've taken nearly £1 million out of our fleet costs because we're moving to electric vehicles. We're reducing our estates costs by sharing accommodation with Aberdeen City Council, Aberdeen Shire Council and many bodies around the country. We're pushing ahead with efficiency, but what we're talking about here isn't efficiency. You can't do this through efficiency. This is more like what you saw in England and Wales over that period, where they didn't make their savings through reform. They made their savings through service reduction. So if you wanted to see an example of withdrawing from communities, focusing on core capability and response and those kind of ties into your communities being, and the model's different in Scotland anyway, but you can kind of see there might be some kind of parallel there. So, I mean, that's maybe an example of a place to look as well.
Thanks very much. Okay, I'm going to bring in Pauline McNeill and then I'll come back to Jamie. I think Jamie's wanting to come in after that. So, Pauline, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. My question's kind of been covered. I was going to ask you what the what would be the implications of having a flat cash budget, but I mean you're outlining quite stark terms to the committee. I just wanted to confirm that I have understood it correctly. David, if I maybe start with you. So all three of you seem to be saying that if this is not resolved, there'll be quite a serious service reduction and perhaps more fundamentally a change in the model of the Scottish police force that we've been used to, an exemplary police force. And I would agree with Jamie Green on that point, quite different from other forces across the UK in the role that Scotland has played and exemplary record on big events. I presume that you've put this to the Cabinet Secretary and to the Scottish Government. I just wondered, given you've outlined this to the committee, which is very concerning, what response are you getting from the government on this stark reality if a flat cash settlement remains for the next 4 years?
Thank you for the question. We've had a series of conversations with the SPA board in private. We've had a series of conversations both with senior officials in the Scottish Government and with the Cabinet Secretary, with the Chief Constable and the Chair. The Cabinet Secretary and the officials are very aware of the potential implications of an RSR-driven budget settlement. They're very sympathetic to it, but as we've already mentioned, we're fully aware of the other pressures on the public sector. One of the things that we have emphasised is that we have delivered the types of savings that are being looked for across the public sector in terms of £200 million worth of savings, 2,000 staff jobs when we kind of brought police reform together, and all of the other efficiencies. So it's the fact that we don't have anywhere else to go because we've delivered reform, although it's an ongoing journey and an ongoing transformation need. They are hugely sympathetic to it and are working to see, as they say, the RSR is not the budget. One of our issues is it's not that far before the budget arrives, and then if the budget does reflect RSR, we'll have a very, very short amount of time to make some very harsh decisions. But they are fully sighted, fully aware and sympathetic.
Do you want to come back in?
Thank you. I just wanted to maybe ask Lynn if you've expressed those views to the government and what response you're getting.
Thank you. The authority has probably two main concerns that they have made. And the first one goes back to a previous question from a member of the committee, the pay award versus staff numbers. And what is unique about policing is the covenant that we have with police officers that they cannot strike. And unlike other public sector workers who can strike, the police can't. And the withdrawal of the goodwill was not taken lightly by police officers to do that. And that was concerning. And we think that's concerning for the future as well. The second thing is the scale. And again, in terms of the detail here, but the scale of what's being asked concerns the authority, and that is because this 4,500 is equivalent to having no police staff, none, in 4 years. You might have your officers, no staff to support them. It's equivalent to not having a C3 operation. These are either ors, or not having any police in Glasgow and Edinburgh on the streets. So it's the scale of what's being faced concerns the authority. We are making those points to the government, and hopefully they will take that into consideration. I said at the start, I hope they rethink their choices. And obviously we will find out in December when the budget is decided.
Mina, could I just ask for a point of clarification from Lynn? These numbers, the 4,400, when you say staff, is that staff and not officers, or is it a mix of staff and officers?
In our terminology, police staff are non-warranted officers. So you've got police officers who are warranted and police staff. The 4,500 covers both police and staff. If policing was protected, police officers, you would have no police staff, none, to support the police.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. David, do you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. The modelling we've done on the 4,500 is a blended mix. One of the things that the Chief Constable's been clear about, and policing's delivered by a combination of officers and staff. There are jobs that the staff do that officers can't do, and obviously vice versa. So what we've modelled in terms of how would you afford 5% over that number of years is both by bringing down officer numbers and staff numbers, and you've got to look at attrition rates, and you've got to look at the types of jobs that you would need to protect. So the 4,500, it would be about a 17% reduction in the police officer numbers and about 31% reduction in the staff under one model, which is the model that kind of got us to the 4,500 we've talked about. But we would bring down both. One of the things that the unions have made very clear to me in my discussions with them is that they would be aghast if we went back to what happened when police reform came about and we actually slashed the staff numbers, because you can offer them voluntary redundancy and VER to protect police numbers. But then what you end up doing is you unbalance policing, and then you end up with police officers having to do staff jobs, which actually makes no sense because of actually economically staff are actually cheaper than officers if you look at the total cost of the public sector. So we are keen to bring down the model on a kind of equitable basis to make sure the balance is maintained. What that balance looks like is a decision for the Chief Constable based on the operating model that we have to put in place at that point in time.
Thanks
very much. I've got quite a lot of supplementary questions, so I'm going to bring in Jamie, and then I'm going to bring in Russell, Katie and Rona. So, Jamie first.
Thank you. Thanks for that further clarification. Just to confirm, the modelling on the 4,400, you, just to be clear on the numbers, you said you've modelled a 17% reduction in police officers and a 31% reduction in staffing. That would be back office operational staff.
Yeah, civilian staff who civilian do a variety staff. Of jobs.
Okay, 17%. Those would be presumably what we would classify as frontline officers, if you like, people who would be out
warranted
in our communities, weren't in the streets responding to events and proactive interaction with the community. 17% is quite a lot. Other than, for example, the removal of community policing or campus policing, other types of community engagement, what would 17% look like to the public in terms of the amount of police officers they would see on the streets, in their communities, responding to emergencies?
Again, I mean, it's a decision for the Chief Constable based on threat, harm and risk and what was happening in society at that time. But at highest level, less police officers on the streets.
Okay.
Less police officers, in schools. So the modelling, not so much our math modelling, if you like, but the operational modelling is always based about where's the acutest risk. So you have to pull back, and which is exactly what happened in England and Wales, where they went away from, it's been reported recently, burglary, housebreaking clear-ups in England and Wales compared to housebreaking clear-ups in Scotland. And, of course, housebreaking is one of the most kind of acute to you personally invasions of your rights, if you like. We would see that adversely affected because we wouldn't have that many officers to do that type of investigation.
So, are you talking about a scenario where you would only respond to send out officers, given reduced numbers, if something was dreadfully serious, life-threatening, serious violent situation, but...
That's the slope we would be on in terms of...
But other types of crime, such as burglary, vandalism, car break-ins, they would be the bottom of the queue, effectively.
Yeah.
Right, OK. Thank you.
Okay. Can I just come in just on the point of what I think of as support staff, but non-warranted staff, as you've described them. I'm just interested to know if that cohort of staff includes your specialist, for example, specialist forensic investigators, IT specialists and so on. So would they be included in that? Those numbers would be.
They would be. So C3, so the civilian staff that work in the 999 and 101, forensic scientists, custody officers who work. We would protect those cohorts of people as far as we could, and we would try and take the civilian staff from, again, you know, the furthest away from threat, harm and risk we could. The challenge we would have, obviously, is the only way we could reduce police staff numbers is through not replacing them, so a recruitment freeze. And, of course, we can't dictate where people leave from, so we may find pressures in those key areas. And secondly, through introduction of a voluntary redundancy and VR scheme. And again, we can't choose who leaves. So although we would try and protect the staff in those key areas, forensic services, C3, custody, key technical roles, key digital forensics roles, key cyber roles, all of which are as much frontline as anything that you see in terms of an officer on the street, we would try and protect those as far as we could. We're at the mercy of where people go in terms of where they leave, when they choose to retire. So we would try and manage it, but we'd be managing what we were given effectively on that one.
Thanks very much for that. OK, I'll now bring in Russell, and then I'll bring in Katie and Rona, and then I'd like to move on from this particular topic. So, Russell.
Thank you. Where is the Chief Constable today?
He'll be at Tully Ellen doing Chief Constable duties. This is a budget scrutiny, which is why you've got the finance people here.
OK, because, I mean, a lot of what is in your submission and what we've heard from you today, I mean, you've said indeed that you can't speak for the Chief Constable, will affect him and his officers. Do you not think it would be important that we should hear from him directly?
I think you will hear from the Chief Constable. I mean, the key issue at the moment is, as we've already mentioned, is that the RSR is what we've been told to use as the planning guide for what would happen going forwards. The operational implications will fall when the budget falls. The Chief Constable and the Chair of the SBA continue to have conversations with officials and the Cabinet Secretary. We're here to talk about the financial implications and the potential of operational implications. As I've said a number of times, the choices for operational service delivery impacts will depend on what the actual budget is, what threat, harm and risk is at a point in time.
I appreciate it's all largely speculative just now. It's worst-case scenario stuff, but some of what you've spoken about will have very real effects on police officers and members of the public. We're talking about 101 services potentially being suspended. And as far as I understand it, murder inquiries in recent years have been subject to MITS investigations as a given. So only, I suppose, a Chief Constable could answer a specific question about an operational need to perhaps change that particular thing. And much of what I think I would like to ask would really only be able to be answered by the Chief Constable or one of his senior officers. Going back to him, you know, the Chief Constable himself, it was reported a month ago that he's pursuing other roles. Have you had discussions with him? Is that in any way connected to these budget projections?
It's not connected. The Chief Constable's looking at the other role was not in connection to the budget, and he's fully committed to Police Scotland going forwards.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I'll bring in Katie and then Rona, and then we'll move on.
Yes, I was wanting to ask a bit more about the modelling with the 31% of civilian police staff. My understanding is that there's been a process called civilianisation over many years in the police service, with roles that perhaps previously would have been carried out by uniformed staff being carried out by civilian staff. And I was wondering what the implications are in reductions in numbers of those types of groups. The convener's already mentioned forensic services and what the implications are in terms of the expertise that Police Scotland has and what's likely to happen if some of those roles go, will that mean that you will have to outsource work of that nature? Would you be reliant, say, on outsourcing work to England and Wales? How would you deal with it if you were losing some of this expertise that's been developed over many, many years? Is that a major issue that you're having to consider?
If we were at a point where we were losing staff numbers because we didn't have the budget, to be quite frank, I wouldn't have the budget to outsource it. Because effectively the money goes either to outsourcing or it goes internally. Our preference in Police Scotland is always to deliver the service in-house because it, generally speaking, is more cost-effective and more cost-efficient. We continue a process of ensuring that any particular job in Police Scotland, we have the right person with the right skills, be it an officer or a civilian member of staff. There was a process and there kind of continues to be a kind of an ongoing refresh of who could that job be done by most effectively. And as I mentioned earlier, when police reform came into being, as part of that journey to kind of save 200 million, there was a very, very large number of police staff took redundancy. To bring the cost base down to what we could afford at the time. That left a good number of jobs that civilian staff did that still needed to be done to keep policing going, which were filled by police officers. We've moved away from that, but that's still a journey that we're ongoing. And as technology improves, as different types of crime like cybercrime comes to the fore, you can use civilian staff in roles which might have been thought of as being frontline policing, but actually now can be done by civilian staff. So we're continuing to refresh and look at our model, but outsourcing is not something that we've looked at. I know the SBA have got a bit of outsourcing going on around some of the drug toxicology, but that's more to do with capacity. You can only hire what's out there. And one of the challenges we have across all of Police Scotland and the SBA is there's a good number of things that we need to do, but the skill set is in demand and we can't compete financially. So our competition is always around the kind of vocation of policing. Mm-hmm. So we do struggle in certain areas.
So, in an area like, say, fingerprinting, if you lose expertise because staff go, does that potentially mean that you're bringing in staff that are officers who are less likely to stay in that role for a lengthy period of time because they're progressing through the organisation or are more expensive? I mean, is that a false economy is what I'm asking?
It's a false economy. I'm not sure that officers will be used in kind of forensic science as per se. But if we were using, on the Police Scotland side, if we were using police officers to cover civilian jobs, which should be done by a civilian, absolutely it's a false economy.
Thanks very much. Rona.
Thanks. Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Just a bit of clarification. So, as I understand it, you don't want a flat cash settlement, but negotiated pay rises are going to cause massive job reductions in the police force. So, can I ask, in previous years, have pay awards always led to a big reduction in staff? Are the two, you know, always related?
No. So, historically, what we've always done is when we get our budget, there's an allocation within the budget, which is usually linked to public sector pay policy. So we always offer public sector pay policy to our staff. We always offer effectively an equivalent to police officers, although there's a different negotiation mechanism for dealing with police officers. In terms of that's our position. Police Scotland's position, that's the SBA's position, that we don't offer more than we can afford. So we never move beyond that. The only time we move beyond that, like we have done with the 5% for this year, is if Scottish Government determines to give us more money to fund a police and staff pay offer than was in our original budget. So we never offer more money than we can afford. And in the most recent pay round, the 5% pay round, which is above what we had in our budget, both Police Scotland from a negotiation position and the SBA only agreed to provide the additional 5% if we had a letter from Scottish Government confirming both additional funding for the budget for this year and ongoing funding for that 5%. So our baselined position for next year going forwards over the next 4 years is what we had this year, including the £37 million, which is the cost of the 5% and the subsequent years of that. We only offered that because we had a written guarantee from the Scottish Government. Mm-hmm. So we don't usually have to lose staff. This is a completely new territory for us.
Yeah, I mean, that was part of the reason my question. I don't remember it being this critical in previous
it's
years.
It's never been like this.
And I get the impression that you're maybe presenting us with a worst-case scenario, unless things change. And I'm looking for a bit of light here. What can you... I mean, apart from probably the obvious more money, is there anything you can suggest that might help, you know, help us see our way through this? Because what you've said sounds
The first point I'd like to make, this is not a worst-case scenario. This is a scenario based on a 5% pay rise. And if inflation's running at 10% plus, then a 5% pay rise... I mean, there's plenty of bodies out there at the moment that are balloting for strike and rejecting 5% pay rise. We've got a 5% pay rise for our officers and staff, so it was a reasonable assumption to put into our modelling. It might not be 5% in subsequent years, but we will adjust the modelling. All we've done is extrapolated it through. In terms of what could we do, we're continuing to push really hard around things like blue light collaboration, local government collaboration. We're working with our fire colleagues, with ambulance service about shared services, about how can we work more effectively. We're accelerating that. We are looking at a number of things in our non-pay areas, as James has said, things like the estate reduction and things like that. But again, with the estate reduction, even though 4,500 was the number that we've talked about under one model, that's not in isolation of the fact that we'd still need to reduce our estate because of the non-pay pressures. Again, we've spoken with the Chief Constable, and the Chief Constable's looking at the options in front of him in terms of, you know, not only do you start to lose officers and staff, but you start to lose your presence because we may have to close police stations if we don't have people in them and we can't afford to run them. So we are looking at that as well.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much indeed.
I'll just move on to Colette now. I think you've maybe got some questions, and then I'll come back to Katie. I think you were interested in asking a little bit around non-warranted staff, unless that's already been... Yep, that's fine. Yeah. And then I'll come back to Russell Finlay. So, Colette.
Yeah, good morning. One of the things that, in terms of efficiencies, looking at efficiencies moving forward, and I believe there was a pilot scheme, or there is a pilot scheme being run for mental health first responders, which effectively means there's an efficiency there within Police Scotland. Can you maybe elaborate more on that and how that would run over the next 4 years? Is that something that you've put in as part of your review?
It's something that we're doing. I can't go into a huge amount of the detail because I'm not that sighted on it. It's more of an operational component. But we are working with mental health nurses to try and reduce the pressure on the front line, where we can redirect through our C3 operation calls to people who are better qualified than sending a patrol car out. So we've absolutely got work going on, working with NHS colleagues to try and, if you like, catch people coming into the system earlier so it doesn't kind of run all the way down to the system. So we have to dispatch a 999 car and we try and redirect them. We will continue to work with fire and ambulance in those types of models. In terms of modelling an effect of an RSR settlement on that, we've not specifically looked at that, again, because of that would be one of those operational service delivery impacts which effectively the Chief Constable would have to sit back and look at the whole range of every type of service we do to determine where he can put his resources.
Okay. And one of the other things that you mentioned was about the body-worn cameras that could have an impact in terms of the reduction in... What impact would that have, and you know, from what you used just now compared to if you were to stop basically allowing police officers to actually wear them?
Well, at the moment, we've only got about 500 officers that wear them. They're the armed officers for the most part. It's a proven fact in England and Wales. We've done a public consultation in Scotland where 81% of the public want our officers to wear body-worn video. The benefits of it are massive. So complaints against police officers, if you've got body-worn video, it really does help to negate complaints. It helps to protect people who are complaining where it's a justified complaint. It helps police officers where it's a malicious complaint. I've spoken to officers who have had their careers derailed because of malicious complaints for years because of the way the system works. It would protect people. It would increase trust in policing massively if people know that these things are being recorded. It's a real weakness that we don't have that basic capability to enhance our trust and confidence in policing.
No more questions.
Okay, thank you very much. My apologies, James. I forgot to bring you in. I know that you were wanting to come in just to respond to Rona Mackay's questions. I'm very welcome to come in now if you still want to.
Yeah, thank you, convener. It was just to go back to that point around, you know, being in different territory now from where we have been. And I suppose if you look at the journey of policing over what will be coming up for 10 years since the start of police reform, the cost of policing in 12-13, in the last year of the old legacy arrangements, was £1,200 million a year. And that dropped to £987 in 2015. So no smoke and mirrors. That was cash reductions. That was a shrinkage of the workforce by 2,000. That was disposing of 165 buildings, getting the economies of scale through better contracting as a single national service and other efficiencies. Now, past that point, the reason we've not then been into that headcount reduction year on year is because there's been that element of real terms protection. But that real terms protection is, I think, a recognition of the fact that the service had undergone such a level of reform and had taken such money out, £200 million a year on a recurring basis. So all the big elements of efficiency have already been delivered. And like I say, we will continue to do that. But in the context of now facing what potentially looks like another 20%, again, on top of the 20% that's been delivered, that's where the concern comes in. And I'm not, you know, I'm scaremongering and all that type of thing. To me, it's unprofessional. So, I mean, that's not what this is about. This is just about setting out in real, you know, in reality of what will happen if that is what, in fact, we face over the 4 years. But again, going back to what the DCO was saying, it is, you know, it's a planning assumption. It's based on flat cash over 4 years. You know, in reality, my own feeling on it is that it won't happen because it can't happen. I mean, and that's not just in the context of policing, but across the public sector to have such a level of reduction over that period of time in a high inflation environment. Because, as I said earlier on, the spending review was based on flat cash in an environment where inflation would peak at, I think, 9.3% this year and drop back down to 2.7 next year. Well, clearly that's not going to happen. We might not even be at 2.7 in 25-26. So I think that, you know, the basis on which the resource spending review was produced at the time and, you know, absolutely the right thing to do, because it does, you know, the intention is right to give longer planning horizons and a bit more certainty to public bodies around multi-year planning. But, you know, the environment has changed so significantly that, you know, that's why I think we're looking at what you're hearing from us today is on the basis of flat cash in a relatively high inflation environment. But that's what the consequences would be if it did play out.
I think, David, you want to come in, and then Lynn, and then I'll come back to Jamie. I think you were wanting to follow up on Colette's questions. David.
Thank you, convener. I think one of the kind of really big frustrations that we have in Police Scotland is that, having successfully delivered a massive public sector transformation that no one else in the UK has done, and delivered these savings and improved service, it feels like a lack of recognition that, as James has just said, you know, if you've already taken 200 million out of the service, you can't take another 200 million. Otherwise, we'd have no non-pay. You know, we'd have no cars, no estate, no technology. So there is a kind of almost like a plea to say, please recognise the fact that we've delivered public sector transformation on a scale that's unprecedented in the UK, that England and Wales have failed to do. We've got one of the best police services in the UK that does one of the best jobs in the UK, and that we're doing it highly efficiently, and we will continue to work and develop that. It's, you know, the men and women in Police Scotland are hugely proud of the job that we do. And it feels like we've got to the point where, you know, everyone's super proud of what we do. And if we have to kind of go back down the hill again, it's going to be both frustrating professionally, but it's also going to be, feels like a lack of recognition of the fact that the things that everyone's been asked to do around public sector transformation, it's not being recognised that that's what we've delivered. There's got to be a recognition of, if you've delivered public sector transformation, that is what we're asked to do, then protect our ability to deliver the policing service that we do for the men and women of Scotland.
Thanks very much. Lynn, would you like to come in?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to come back to the question on mental health, if I may. I appreciate that this committee has got a real interest in mental health issues in terms of the challenges on policing and also on the mental health and wellbeing of police officers. So I know it's been framed sometimes in terms of efficiency, but it's much more than that in terms of the work that's going on at the C3 is to get the right result for the citizen. In the best way possible. And that's something that the authority has a priority to look at. And I know there is going to be a roundtable in December, I think. Convener, you've been invited to speak at it, as has the Cabinet Secretary, just to look at that, the mental health challenges in the citizens, in the community, on policing, so we can get some better answers to how we deal with it. C3 is only a small part of that.
And I'll bring in Rona just for a small supplementary. Very briefly, yeah. Just Jamie.
Just, yeah, David Pageant, I totally agree with what you're saying. I think, you know, we are very proud of the police service and what they've achieved and the transformation. Don't disagree with any of that. I just wanted to say that perhaps you could recognise too that the Scottish Government is in new territory and very, very challenging territory, and, you know, with a fixed budget that's reducing. And, you know, I know you know that, so it would just be a case of, you know, having to work together to try and work something out. But it's not a case of it's not being recognised, because I think it has. Just wanted to put that on record. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay, thank you. Jamie, do you want to come back in, and then I'll bring in Russell.
Finally. Yeah, two things. The first is, I apologies for my misunderstanding. I thought this potential modelling of a reduction of nearly 4,500 staff and officers is the worst case, but it's not.
Yeah, it's 5%.
Therefore, if a 5% pay offer was rejected and you had to pay more to them to keep them effectively, or to stop industrial action or strikes or whatever method is available to them, what would happen to that 4,400? Are we talking 5,000, 6,000, 7,000? Is it doubling? Does 10% mean 8,000, 9,000? Reduction?
I mean, we could extrapolate the model pretty much any way you like. I mean, there is an issue for the... At some point, there's a kind of a model, an operational model, where the Chief Constable says, I cannot go below that number to deliver his statutory duties. So that would influence what we were able to offer as a pay settlement. But, yeah, if it was more than... 5%. If it went up 1%, it's another 11 million. That's another 225 people.
Okay, so it's about 225 people for every percentage point pay rise. Okay, that's quite a lot. The Scottish Police Federation, who are not here today, but have submitted written evidence to us, I'm going to ask to what extent you agree or disagree with the following. They say that if the current plans come to fruition, crime will increase, victims will be let down, public confidence will diminish, and more people will be left in crisis. Indeed, many offenders will be unlikely to face any form of sanction or face any form of justice. Do you agree or disagree with that statement?
I think if you look at the experience in England and Wales, you'd have to agree with it.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Russell Finlay.
Thank you. I mean, a lot of what we've heard so far, frankly, is terrifying. Some of the things that you said, and I really appreciate your candour. It's necessary, but, you know, it can't be easy to be so forthright with some of this stuff. I've got two sort of separate questions, and the first one relates to body cameras, I suppose, being an example generally of equipment issues and how these proposed budgets will affect that. In your opening statement, you said that England and Wales pretty much universal rollout of cameras, and indeed second generation cameras. Are you going to any supermarket, the security guards are wearing them? But Police Scotland have only got around 500, and they're mostly with armed officers. It seems pretty basic, and, you know, we're facing these really serious financial pressures. is there not an element of not having fixed the roof when the sun was shining? Is there not any sense that that's been a hugely missed opportunity then, and someone somewhere should have prioritised this or found the money to make that happen?
It's, I mean, it'll be about £25 million over 5 years to roll out national body worn video. Part of the why haven't we done it yet, given that we've, you know, ongoing transformational activity in Police Scotland, is you've got to be conscious of the fact that when we're using body-worn video, you need to capture the data, then you need to secure the data somewhere, because it could be used in, obviously, a court. The data's got to be secure. You can't have a break in the chain of evidence. That links to our digital data and ICT strategy in terms of the multitude of systems that we inherited from the police forces, the legacy police forces, and the journey that we've been on to try and create a single national digital platform that would allow us to have the infrastructure underneath national body-worn video. It also links to the DESC project, which is a kind of a Scottish Government, Crown, courts, Police Scotland digital project to allow evidence that could be captured on things like body-worn video to kind of go through digitally right through the justice system, which would be very efficient and reduce lots of pressure on the justice system. So why haven't we done it yet? One, we've not really had the capital to do it yet. We've not had the capital and revenue to fix a lot of the infrastructure the way we wanted it to. We're at the point where we were building the initial business case because the timing was right to make that submission. One of the big challenges we've got is in a digital-first environment, which is obviously something we want to do and it's a Scottish Government priority, digital-first effectively means revenue pressure. You're paying for revenue, you're not reliant upon capital per se. So one of the big issues with body-worn video is we'll need additional revenue to pay for the licences, to pay for the data capture. And, of course, revenue is the thing that's under most pressure.
Sure. I mean, on saying that, all the other forces, the dozens of forces elsewhere in the UK, have managed to overcome similar challenges, presumably, and prioritised that spending. Moving on to the next issue, and it's to do with mental health. Now, Lynn has already touched on officers dealing with people in the community who require mental health support and treatment. I'm coming at it from a slightly different position, and that is police officers' mental health. We've heard some very strong evidence of officers, the pressures they're under and the struggles they face, and how that can seriously impact on their well-being and indeed a sense that they do not currently have the support that they need. There have been some absolutely tragic outcomes with officers taking their own lives and others coming close to doing so. If even this partly comes to pass, that's only going to get a whole lot worse. What thought has been given to improving the support for officers?
Mental health, mental well-being and general well-being is right at the top of everything we do, because at the end of the day, you can't have a police service without having people. And unless we do the utmost to protect our people who do one of the most difficult jobs in society, you cannot sustain the police service. There's been... the Chief Constable made a commitment a good number of years ago now to trying to protect and support police officers and staff in terms of their mental health and their well-being. So we've done an awful lot to try and protect and help them. We have got 23,000 people in the workforce, officers and staff. We have got well-being teams, we've got well-being managers, are trying to invest more in it. We do have an outsourced service to help us with specialist performances in there. We would like to put more money into it, but obviously we're restricted because I'm already struggling. We're struggling at the moment this year with our own budgets because of the financial year 22-23 because of the inflationary effect. And the other issue we've got at the moment is because we started the year down on our police officer numbers because of COVID and because of training, it's meant that we don't we were about 400 short at the start of this financial year. What that's meant is we're having to push an awful lot more money into overtime. Now that provides a level of service, but it also puts a lot more pressure on our officers and staff. So we're kind of almost double what we planned for in overtime. One of the things that we are acutely aware of is that police officers and staff will try and deliver the same type of service they've always delivered because they don't want to let people down. If the workforce shrinks, it doesn't shrink and then we can use overtime. It shrinks full stop. So if people try and provide the same level of service, then they're going to be going over and above and beyond, and that's going to put more pressure on them. So we are acutely aware of the fact that police officers and staff will not want to let people down, even if we're not paying them not to let people down, and they will face increasing pressure and mental health pressure. So we make mistakes. We're a really big organisation. We have a lot of people, and I do recognise and apologise for where we've handled things badly. But where we do handle things badly, we investigate it fully and then we try and fix it going forwards. And it is probably the most important thing on the Chief Constable's list of priorities alongside violence against police officers and staff.
Yeah, I think Lynn's wanting. Yep. Sorry.
Yep. Yeah. Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Mr. Finlay. I'd just maybe like to give some context of where this sits in the oversight of the authority in terms of mental health of officers. So the first thing that it is very much a priority. And the first thing that we did was when we reviewed our governance structures, we separated out the resources committee that used to look at people issues, and we've now got a separate people committee that focuses on the issues that affect police officers and staff. The other change was that the unions and staff associations are invited to that meeting, and they weren't before, and they're asked to contribute to any conversations, any reports around these issues. The other thing, and David's touched on it as well, things have not gone as we would like, and lessons learned is very much part of the authorities' role, and they try to link up with what's been heard in the People Committee with what's been heard in the Legal Committee, where sometimes this can end up in terms of financial implications. So it's a very important authority. It is a priority for them, and as I said, I think the Chair contributed to the roundtable that you convened to look at mental health issues, and we see this as a major area for us going forward.
Thank you very much. And I think, Bruno, you wanted to come in just
quickly. Sorry, just a quick point. Sorry, just very quickly to recap. Mm-hmm. So in terms of the body cameras, we're not going to see them anytime soon. And mental health, there's no extra money. But there's some organisational issues that can be improved.
We would absolutely, if the budget reflected the RSR, it wouldn't be just a straightforward, we'll reduce numbers. It will have to look at what types of operational service delivery can we deliver, and also how can we protect our people as much as they need to be protected to enable them to do the job. So again, that will be that kind of that challenge that the Chief Constable's got, which is what services do I pull back? Do I provide an extra £1 million for a wellbeing contract, or do I shut two police stations? It's that type of kind of dilemma.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Bruno.
Thank you. Just on the theme of mental health, I want to ask you about the external contract you have with Optima Health for officers. Can you tell us what the value of that contract is, what the duration of it is, and have you ever considered bringing the services in-house? Would that be more efficient?
I could maybe start with the question. So the contract will expire on the 31st of March 2024. That's after exercising a one-year extension. Now, that's...
Sorry to interrupt. So effectively, is it a three-year, four-year contract they've got?
Six.
Six.
Five with one-year extension.
Okay, right. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, and I can... I'll clarify after the meeting the exact value, but I think it's in the region of £1 to £2 million a year, but I can get clarity over that. Okay. What I would say is, with regards to options beyond that, we've now got a window here at the moment, and the HR team within Police Scotland are looking at exactly what the service offering needs to be, and recognising the fact that it's becoming increasingly complex, and actually they're looking to see what enhancements can be made, but that's in the context, obviously, mm-hmm. of where we do get to with the spending review and the availability of resources. So it is something that's actively being considered at the moment about what the future needs to look like, and whether, it's an outsourced with additional enhancements in the specification or what or alternative models, but that's something that will be picked up on over the coming months.
Thanks. And can I just maybe ask Lynn if there's an evaluation of the service provided by that contract done? You know, I mean, so you award, it's quite a long, lengthy contract that's awarded, and do you, you know, do you do reviews of how effective it is with the officers at any point?
The People Committee gets regular reports on a whole, it's like a dashboard of issues to do with staff welfare, and how the contract is performing comes up at those committees around questions.
Well, where does that information come from the officers? Or
It comes from the it will come from the our colleagues in P&D, which is personnel and development.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm wondering where they get the information. Is it fed back to them from officers, or is it Optima marking their own homework, you know, saying, well, we're doing a good job? Or
we have a series of forums by which the Federation and unions attend, wellbeing forums. So we both have input from Optima in terms of, you know, service level agreements, contracts, contract performance, things like that. But we also have feedback directly from the unions and the Federation. And we'll get individual members who are going through the service dealing with their HR contact in terms of giving us direct feedback. So there's a number of touch points. And we do, the Federation and unions sit on the Health and Wellbeing Board. So there's a number of kind of areas where both unions and Federation are able to input into things. I am conscious of the fact that you've had a private session with some officers and I'm aware of some of the kind of issues that have risen there. As I said, we're a big organisation and sometimes, we get it wrong and we need to kind of find out where we got it wrong and then we need to fix it. And secondly, unfortunately, with ill health retirals, with injuries on duties and something like that, a lot of it is down to independent medical examiners, not us, determining whether it was an injury on duty or it doesn't qualify. If the decision goes against someone, they can be very, very disgruntled about it and very unhappy with the world and very unhappy with Police Scotland and feel it's unfair. And that will generate a lot of angst. And I have huge kind of sympathy with people who kind of find themselves in that position. So what we've got to do is just ensure that where the service isn't as good as it should be, genuinely shouldn't be, that we identify it from either people going through the process from the unions or from our own feedback from Optima, and we fix it. And that we probably explain better to people who have not got an outcome that they were hoping for because of independent medical practitioners, why they're in that position, and try and provide them as much support, notwithstanding they may not have got what they hoped to get.
I think the committee concern was, from our impression, it seemed to offer a kind of one-size-fits-all solution, not recognising the unique pressures of policing and incidents and things like that, which so it brings you back to the point of maybe an in-house service would provide that better. You've just said you're going to be looking at the modelling, but that was our concern, that, you know, it was just a general well-being service and not, you know, homing in on the experiences of officers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bring in Fulton now.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I've sat in this committee, or at least this predecessor committee, for 6 years now, and along with my colleague Rona Mackay, I think we're the only two in that position. And I have to say that this, in budget scrutiny, is the starkest that I've heard. Indeed, in previous sessions, it wasn't Jamie or Russell, but perhaps you could say that their colleagues would actually have been asking questions to try and get you to say what you've said today. And, you know, I think, you know, in all credit to the police, you've always came to the committees and said, no, we can manage this, we can manage this. And today, for me, it's just totally different. I think we need to set up and take notes of that, because, like you said, James, you wouldn't come and scaremonger. And I think you said that, and we've seen that previously. So I think that is really, really important. And none of us can be in any doubt about the serious pressures that you're putting today. And I guess that you've got an expectation that this committee will take that back to government, including the four of us who are government backbenchers, and we will do that. But on the same token, as Ronan Mackay raised, I would hope, and this is for the record rather than a question, because I know he's been wanting to be involved in politics, I'd hope that our Conservative colleagues here also use their influence in the position that they're in to ensure that the new Prime Minister doesn't take a sledgehammer to public services and put the Scottish Government in that position as well. But, as I said, firstly, this committee's job is to scrutinise the Scottish Government, and there's no getting away from that. But I just wanted to put on record what I've heard today, because I do think that it has been very stark and very different from previous years. The question I wanted to ask was something, David, that you've already touched on, and it's about that interaction with other services. We're going to hear from the Fire Service in a wee bit, and I'm guessing that they'll maybe have a similar thing to say, but there's a flat settlement, flat cash settlement for other key justice sector organisations, including the Fire Rescue Service, courts and others. How do you think, have you had any thought about how that will impact on yourselves? Because obviously you all work together. What sort of impacts do you see coming down the line if the cuts, if you like, go ahead with these other services as well? How's it all going to work?
As I said, we work very closely with Fire and Ambulance. We actually have a Blue Light Collaboration Board, which I chair along with the Interim Chief Fire Officer, who's sat behind me, Ross, and Scottish Ambulance. We are all working, knowing that, and we discuss it as a group of three, kind of blue light bodies, that the huge pressures we're all facing, and we are actively looking at accelerating collaboration opportunities across the three services. We actually held a conference, I think it was on the 4th of October, where we had, I think, about a dozen different work streams of IT people, procurement people, P&D people, finance people, strategy people, all sitting together virtually, looking at how we could work together to reduce costs and improve service, not just for one service, but for all of the services. We're actually talking in the Blue Light Collaboration Committee about trying to do shared cost pressure management, so that if one of us could save some money in a particular area, could we help spread that across three services? So we're probably working, we've always tried to collaborate, and we've got a long history of collaboration, especially with the fire service, but we're more acutely working over the last couple of years, and especially since RSR, where we're really, really trying to, can we get the three of us to deliver an outcome that helps all of us in the face of that kind of flat cash environment. So we're working extremely, and also other partners. Obviously, councils, James already mentioned the NEDIP project, where we've saved a small fortune for both Police Scotland and improved rental income for Aberdeenshire Council and Aberdeen Council on an ongoing basis. So we're constantly looking for opportunities for collaboration.
No, that's really good to hear. And I know that you have referenced it. You know, obviously you're worried about the impact and all the services and how that collaboration can work. In terms of possible you know, ways forward, though, do you think that any upcoming legislative changes can help? You know, obviously this committee's looking at the bail and release bill. There's going to be a criminal law reform coming up. I know that the police will feed into them, as you always do, but have you had any thought how these sort of reforms could perhaps help in these challenging financial times? Or is that a bit off until the bill's actually come before you?
Probably reserve judgment until the bill comes. What I would say about any new legislation, it tends to put more pressure on us. It usually involves more training and more work that we have to do. Anything that involves, to be honest, more legislation coming through, generally speaking, means more work and more cost.
Yeah, I do appreciate it. But these particular bills that I mentioned, I think they're an attempt. I think that the government have sort of said is they are an attempt to try and help with pressures in the system. But of course, you are right, they'll initially come with more training and learning about them. Thanks very much, appreciate that.
Thank you very much. Before I bring in Pauline McNeill, Jamie, did you want to come in on...
Yeah, it's a supplementary question that I've been mulling over as the conversation's been going on, and that's to pose another scenario to you. If, as a result of the evidence you've given or today's oral session, government ministers are sitting in their offices and listening and take action, and instead of a flat cash settlement, as is the case currently, you've been forecasting and scenario planning around, they do offer an increase in your budget. we don't know what that may be if it does occur, but assuming there were an increase in your budget, would that simply be swallowed up by the pay increase? Because it sounds to me like even if you got a 5% increase in cash terms in your budget, it would simply disappear into any potential pay increase anyway. So as a result of that, you would still be halting ICT upgrades. You would still have problems with fleet investment. You would still not be rolling out body-worn cameras. You would still have problems with recruitment and retention and so on and so forth. So what I'm asking then is, in another scenario, if the government do offer you cash, obviously we are welcome to put a number on it if you have one, but if you don't, even if they do offer more money, are we still staring down the barrel of potential problems or cuts anyway?
I think, I mean, we've had a lot of conversations with senior officials and the Cabinet Secretary, so they have been fully engaged with us and they're fully aware of the various scenarios and where we could be. In terms of any additional capital, obviously, or capital or revenue, we would welcome it. Whether it would be sufficient to fund future pay increases depends on how much it is. We are looking, because we're constantly looking to evolve as a service, so we are looking at our operating models. There's a number of things that we're looking at to try and improve how efficient we are. A lot of these take a little bit of time. It might be that with an additional cash settlement, it helps us towards future pay, and it might help us in terms of we may have to accelerate a model change or something like that. So it may result in a differentiated service. But we're always looking at differentiated services anyway because of, you know, cybercrime, serious organised crime. It kind of, there's an ebb and flow to things. It might result in a change in the model if we got additional cash, but not as much as we needed. Again, it would be for the Chief to make a determination on that.
Okay, that probably raises more questions than answers, I'm afraid, but okay.
Thanks very much. Pauline, would you like to come in now, and then I'll finish off with our final question for the panel. Pauline.
Thank you, Convener. So what we've heard this morning is stark and concerning, but we haven't even got to the question of what we've heard already in evidence, which is the number of police officers that have indicated they will retire or have retired. So I'm bound to ask the panel, given what you said about a flash cash settlement, all the savings you've already made, the pressure on you for a pay increase for staff and police officers, what impact is the impending retirement of police officers? And do you have any up-to-date numbers on that? So, previously, we did see some numbers around the number of officers who have already indicated that they will retire with either their 30-year service or retire early. It was some relationship with some pension changes, although it's the Federation have said that is not the only reason why we're losing police officers. They've said that the morale in the force is low and... in fact, I raised this with the First Minister only a few months ago, that officers were complaining of their days being cancelled at the last minute, not really being given proper welfare treatment and so on. And so that's the reason why we're losing officers. I wondered if you were able to comment on the impact of that to date, and any update on the figures would be very welcome indeed. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you for the question. Our five-year average on retirements over a kind of calendar year would usually be about 573. This year, as of I think last week, we're at 1,118 retirements. I think the key thing to note there is usually during the last kind of calendar quarter of October to December, we have 137 retirements is a five-year average. We're at 124 retirements in October. So as you can see, that's probably going to take it well above that average. Effectively, it's kind of more than double at the moment. It is that the peak has kind of come and gone, and it's starting to settle down at a new number. We used to kind of have an average of high 60s In terms of average people leaving the service, we're probably kind of running around the kind of 83 a month at the moment. We do expect that there might be another peak as we kind of get into April next year, and we're watching that position carefully. That in itself brings its own challenges, because obviously these are the people with the most experience in policing. So quite often things like superintendents, chief inspectors. So we are having to look very carefully and manage very carefully the service in terms of training for people with the skills and on call and things like that. So we are monitoring the pensions impact. It will have an ongoing impact. We do expect to see more people retiring from the service month on month than was previously the case. And there may well be in April of next year another bit of a spike, purely because of the 5% pay rise that we gave in this financial year will kind of wash through into pensions at that point. And then October 23, there's the pensions remedy regulations become effective, and that might have an effect as well. So we're keeping a really close eye on what that means in terms of both overall numbers and the level of experience in the service. Hopefully that answers the question.
I mean, thank you very much. David, perhaps you can't answer this, and perhaps it does need to be the Chief Constable, but Ted, I raised this issue before, so we can see how concerning that is based on those numbers, that one of the reasons that police officers are choosing to retire is because of the conditions they're working in. For example, as I said, having their rest days cancelled and holidays cancelled at the last minute. I mean, don't answer this if you feel it's for me to Chief Constable, but has there been any response to that? I mean, and I've thought as an organisation, you want to try and retain those police officers, retain that experience, given the stark things you've outlined to the committee. I wondered, are you able to say anything about how you're going to try and address that?
So we do want to retain people with experience, obviously. Most people leave the service through retirement. The spike that came in April was because of the removal of the commutation cap. Effectively, it gave officers with 25 years service over the age of 50 the ability to access a higher lump sum of cash, and that's what they've done. In terms of can we retain skills, one of the things we have been looking at, and we're making progress in this, is that there's a number of officers who leave the service as warranted police officers but then come back in as experienced civilians. So that's another thing that we are looking at. But the kind of impact of pensions on our workforce is something that we're monitoring tightly.
See that last sentence? You said that you're monitoring the police officers leave and come back as civilians. Is a suggestion that they wouldn't be able to do that, because that's encouraging them to take retirement and come back and work as civilians. Is that what you meant?
No, if we've got an officer that's retiring because they can retire effectively, and there's a job that they could do as a civilian, then we'll bring them in if there's a job vacancy, because of there's good skills and experience there. But it's got to be the right fit. It can't be kind of jobs for the boys as such. It's got to be a role that we need, and they've got to have the right skills and experience. But it is a valuable resource.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you very much. Time's against us, and I'd like to draw the session to a close. There's been some helpful discussion this morning. I'd just like to ask one final question, just in follow-up to the discussion about body-worn cameras and sort of kit and resources that Russell Frindley brought up. Obviously, your IT refresh plan that you spoke about earlier, that's a sort of critical sort of organisational requirement. But I was just interested to know if the potential cuts coming forward would impact on progress with that plan. So I'm thinking about areas such as the sort of mobile phone data triage work that's going on, photo lab, that type of thing. So just interested in whether or not there would be implications for that operational delivery.
Any technology spend that we have planned at the moment around enhancing our digital capability, our technology capability across any of the kind of programmes that we've got, all of those are under review in terms of whether we can afford them or not at the moment. And it may be the case that we have to shift our transformation programme from capability enhancement, which has been the focus for the past good number of years, to more kind of radical cost saving programs. Again, it's something that we're looking at, looking down every kind of crevice to try and find ways of saving money at the moment. I kind of just add, Convener, I mean, one of the things that, that James has mentioned is, and Mr. McGregor's mentioned is, you know, we're not here to shroud wave. What we're just pointing out is the actual maths of a resource spending review driven budget and the potential consequences, as the Chief's put in the letter. We don't want to kind of get into what exact service could be withdrawn, what would the delay be on a 999 call. We actually don't know until we get a budget. We've got all the modelling ready. We'll apply the modelling once we get a budget, and then we'll present that to the Chief Constable, and he'll have to take everything into consideration, both the budget, the modelling, what we have in front of us, and what the, you know, the societal position is at that point.
Thanks very much. James.
Thank you, Convener. It was just to say, yeah, there's a very close link between investment priorities when you look at the capital allocation and you look at the resource allocation. So in the capital, it's flat, is what we're told to plan on for the next number of years. But flat, as you know, in real terms, is a reduction. And our capital budget is broadly split into two. It's split on maintaining, insofar as we can, our existing asset base around ICT, vehicles, specialist policing equipment and the buildings. And then on transformation, which is some of the things around the DDICT and other programmes. And as you shrink the buying power, if you like, of that capital budget, then it will gravitate towards maintaining the asset base. I mean, we're not maintaining our buildings. The size of our estate, based on a flat cash model, is not sustainable, so we wouldn't have to rationalise that estate. But the cost of doing maintenance work on the estate is running far higher than 10%. Construction inflation and materials around that is much higher than that. So, you know, whilst you might take the overall budget and go, well, you know, a 10% inflation, that's reducing the buying power, in certain areas it's considerably higher than that. So what you'd probably see is a core focus on maintaining what we need to do for statutory health and safety around the estate and making sure the vehicles are safe and the core systems are protected, and then that will leave a lesser amount for doing transformation work. And as the DCO says, that's more likely to then have to be focused on cost reduction initiatives. And then that pressure around the revenue budget in itself creates pressure on the capital budget, because if you don't maintain the upkeep of your buildings from a revenue maintenance perspective, it means that you get a deterioration in the fabric of the building, which then has bigger repair costs around things like replacing a roof, because you haven't maintained it over a period of time. So you get into a kind of downward spiral on that. So I think the question that you ask is really pertinent, and that, yeah, that is a real concern for us, our ability to actually take things forward with flat cash for both revenue and capital diminishes. And also, I suppose, a concern over the reform budget, which hasn't been mentioned, that provides the resources that we need to do change activity and where we might be around that into next year and beyond.
Yeah. All of that hits wellbeing as well. I mean, that's the, as the committee is aware of, we've quite rightly had lots of criticism in the past from the Federation and unions about not maintaining buildings and, you know, gaffer take on cars. We have tried to move away from that. We've made a lot of good improvements, but with the direction of travel we're going at the moment, because we're only doing essential health and safety repairs now across the estate, we've had to cut that right back this year because of inflation. We're going to go straight back to where we were before, where unfortunately we have to wait for something to break before we fix it.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Thank you all for... Sorry?
Thank you. Normally we don't or try and avoid as a committee party political issues, but I thought it was important just to get on the record response to the points made by Fulton McGregor earlier. And they are that, you know, the Scottish Government makes decisions about how it spends money. The Scottish Government is in receipt of a record £41 billion block grant from the UK Government, and the Chief Constable himself told the SPA in June, and I quote, that the Scottish Government clearly sets out its spending priorities, and policing is not among those stated priorities. So I think that perhaps helps give us some context to the bigger financial picture. So thank you.
Thank you very much indeed for attending. I appreciate that. And as usual, if members have got any further questions, then we'll follow that up in writing. And we'll now have a short pause to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. And I now welcome our second panel of witnesses to the meeting this morning. We've got Mr. Ross Haggart, Interim Chief Officer, Mr. Stuart Stevens, Interim Deputy Chief Officer, and Mr. John Thompson, Acting Director of Finance and Procurement at the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. So a very warm welcome to you all. So I think, Mr. Haggart, you would like to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Convener, morning, Committee members, and thanks for your time this morning. As you've said, I'm Ross Haggart. I'm the Interim Chief Officer of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and with me this morning, I've got Stuart Stevens, Interim Deputy Chief Officer, and John Thompson, Acting Director of Finance and Procurement. The Scottish Fire and Rescue Service's written submission for this meeting is contained within the agenda pack, and within our submission we've provided some information in respect of the four areas requested by the committee. That's namely the assessment we are making of the impact of a possible flat cash settlement on the delivery of our services for 2023-24, the contingency plans we are developing, and what the impacts may be on SFRS and our services to communities. Secondly, the assessment we are making of the impact of a possible flat cash settlement on our capital spending for 2023-24. Thirdly, the assessment we are making of the long-term impact of the possible flat cash settlement out to 26-27 if the present inflationary cycle continues beyond this year. And finally, we've made some additional comments as well within our submission in terms of the potential impact of the flat cash settlement on the SFRS. Since the publication of the resource spending review, we've been exploring the implications of the indicative flat cash figures and the application of a flat cash settlement to the services resource budget, which currently sits at £294.207 million. Similarly to the questions, we've approached this in two stages. Firstly, we're exploring savings we would need to start making for 23-24. And secondly, we're looking at what a 2 to 4 year programme of work would look like, i.e. taking us from 24-25 to 26-27 to make longer term savings. This has been supported by us developing a range of potential future financial scenarios utilising our medium term financial model, which have informed our considerations to date, and I'm sure John can provide some additional information on that modelling. As outlined in our submission, our modelling indicates that a flat cash settlement in 23-24 would require the services to make savings in the range of £12 to £18 million next year. Thereafter, as we move further into the future, it becomes more challenging to accurately predict the impacts of the indicative budget. This is because key variables that will impact upon the cost base of the service are more difficult to forecast with a degree of accuracy, essentially the medium to long-term impact of inflation and also pay settlements for staff over this period. We have set out, however, in our submission, indicative savings required by the end of the four-year period of between £29 and £43 million across the services budget. Although there are degrees of uncertainty within the modelling, it does, however, provide us with indications of the potential scale of the challenges we may face and the measures we may need to take to overcome these from a resource budget perspective, and further details are provided in our written submission in relation to that. In respect of our capital budget, we've also set out within our written submission the impacts of it remaining at its current level of £32.5 million per annum. This is very much within the context of the current condition and suitability of our community fire stations, vehicle fleet and equipment. And again, further details around this are contained within our written submission. Thank you again for your time this morning. Stuart, John and I will be more than happy to provide any additional information and answer any questions you may have on our written submission that will assist the committee with its pre-budget scrutiny work. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ross. John, I'll just bring you in if you would like to just follow up from Ross's opening statement.
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and thanks also to committee members, and good morning to all. And as Ross has indicated, we have produced a number of financial scenarios, and I guess it's important to stress that they are financial scenarios, but they're based on the reality of what we are facing as a service in terms of the inflationary potential inflationary impacts and also the pay award impacts. And I'll explain a wee bit more about some of the assumptions that we've made behind that. I guess the thing that I would really highlight, similar to what Police Scotland have said in terms of the immediate impact in terms of 23-24, because we're talking about that range of between £12 million and £18 million, which is a significant level of saving that we require. However, that will be also that cumulative impact in terms of that four-year period, it could potentially ramp up to £43 million. But just to make sure I give an indication of the assumptions behind it, because it's all based on assumptions in these financial scenarios. So in terms of inflation, we have assumed inflation for 22-23 at 9%, for 23-24 at 6%, and 2% thereafter in 24-25. Now, anyone can suggest, is that the right position? But that's the target inflationary pressure, so therefore our modelling takes that into account. In addition, we have looked at the fact that there is a likelihood that we will have to cover the pay award for this year. 5% is certainly the figure that's been negotiated around. However, that will flow through into the next financial year, 23-24, because we'll have to find recurring savings for that pay award. Plus, we've done some financial scenarios that say, well, what will happen if we have a subsequent 5% pay award in 23-24? And that's what gets us to the position of the £43 million in cumulative savings, just so that the committee are clear on our assumptions behind the modelling. Obviously, they are financial scenarios, and we are looking at a range of scenarios. I think I've had about 23 scenarios to date, based on different variations in terms of pay award, in terms of inflationary pressures, and how we think. And I guess these scenarios are really just to guide us as to what the scale of the challenge will be for the service. The other thing that I wanted to mention or to highlight is that flat cash does have a significant impact on the service. Our staff costs are 80% of our overall budget, and therefore to mean flat cash means that we will potentially have to reduce our staff bill by looking at the pay award increase on a year-on-year basis. And that's another important factor to recognise, that we are having to make these savings within an annual financial framework. Within the service, there is obviously no compulsory redundancy, so possible reductions are basically based on retirees and natural wastage across the service. And just as a kind of metric, a 1% pay award costs £2 million for the service. And in terms of our non-pay, therefore, that's actually 20% of our budget. And therefore, when I look at the pressures in terms of inflation, whilst we have the thought process that inflation is the headline 9%, 10%, it's not uniform across how it impacts the organisation. So, for example, we are expressing pressures on fuel at 45% increase in prices, electricity 30%, gas 89%. Construction cost in the capital side is about 30%. So whilst we are talking about an average headline inflation, there is incredible pressure coming through the supply chain, both in terms of the resource spending review and also in terms of our capital position. The final thing is that the service doesn't hold reserves. So when we are talking about a position where we are looking over a four-year period, it would be really advantageous to have a reserve position so that you could perhaps potentially bank savings and then carry that forward into future years. But the service doesn't have that financial lever. That's my opening statement, convener, and I open up for questions.
Thank you very much indeed. Thanks for that. Before I open it up to questions, I wonder if I may, if I can just pick up on the point that you raised about staffing and the potential implications that you face within the current sort of financial constraints that we're facing. And obviously you were in the committee room earlier when Police Scotland were outlining some of the scenarios that they potentially face. I just wondered if perhaps you could provide any more detail on what what considerations you may have to make around staffing, workforce planning and your staffing profile going forward?
If I could answer that, please, convener. So what we are seeking to do at the moment is balance the savings that we are needing to make across the whole of the organisation. And we want to, because of the nature of our organisation, we clearly want to prioritise the delivery of frontline services to communities and outcomes for communities. However, as we have outlined in our written submission, 80% of our budget is on staff employment costs, and of that, around 80% is spent on operational staff costs, including operations control personnel. So that's round about 64% of our costs are spent on operational staff costs. So therefore, savings of the magnitude that we have to make, we will not be able to make savings of those magnitudes without that impacting upon staffing within the organisation and operational staffing within the organisation. In terms of the firefighter numbers, we essentially employ different types of staff across the organisation in an operational context. We employ whole-time, which are full-time firefighters, and we've got 74 fire stations across Scotland that employ full-time firefighters. We've also got on-call firefighters across Scotland, and that they comprise personnel that are conditioned to the retained and the volunteer duty system. So when we talk about firefighters, we have got different categories of firefighters, whole-time firefighters and on-call firefighters. As I've already said, we will always seek to protect frontline service delivery for communities. But as I've said, the current staffing arrangements and the current service delivery model that we have got would not be sustainable in its current form if the resource spending review figures turned into annual budgets for us. Anything that we would do to change our service delivery model, we would always do that based upon community risk, whilst maintaining safety of our firefighters. And any proposals for any significant changes we made to that model, we would do so accompanied by appropriate stakeholder engagement and consultation, and we would do specific impact assessments on any specific changes that we would make. In terms of the suite of options that would be open to us to reduce the cost from our staffing budget, we could look at a number of things, such as looking at the crewing arrangements on particular fire stations, and that might mean changing those crewing arrangements for example, from whole-time to on-call firefighters on a risk-assessed basis. We may have to remove fire appliances from service going forward, and we also may have to close some community fire stations as well. So that would be the suite of measures that we could use in order to continue to deliver a balanced budget under whatever the budgets are going forwards, whether it's flat cash as per the resource spending review or anything else going forward. There's not therefore necessarily a link directly between firefighter numbers and our budget, because we might have firefighters conditioned to different duty systems going forward. However, as John's pointed out, we do have we support the Scottish Government's no compulsory redundancy policy, so we would reduce any numbers of our headcounts through retirements, other leavers and vacancy management, and that's across all staff groups, operational and support staff as well. That clearly could cause challenges, because where people retire from or where people leave the organisation geographically might not match with where we think that we can make risk-based decisions regarding our crewing going forwards. To give an indicative figure, however, we can employ approximately 28 whole-time firefighters for a cost of £1 million. So for each £1 million that we've got, we can employ 28 whole-time firefighters. That roughly equates to one whole-time appliance being crewed by firefighters 24 hours a day, 365 days per year. So again, that £1 million is roughly how much it costs us to crew one whole-time fire appliance 24 hours a day. And as John's already mentioned, each 1% pay rise across the service equates to approximately £2 million of additional costs to us. So hopefully that sets out the kind of quantum of the numbers, and hopefully you'll appreciate that in making those savings, however, it might not translate into readily into firefighter numbers, because we might change the duty pattern that firefighters are working. However, that of itself is not without consequences, because clearly on-call firefighters would need to mobilise to stations, to mobilise to incidents and stuff like that. So all of these things will have impacts upon communities, but it's not as easy just to translate a numerical figure into firefighter numbers because of the different duty systems we've got.
Thanks very much. That's really helpful. Just on the subject of kind of staffing numbers, again, we heard earlier from Police Scotland, who predicted that, or predicted around about a £4,500 They predicted that there would have to be around about a £4,500 cut in staff over 5 years in order to service a 5% pay award. I'm just wondering if you've done any sort of modelling that would allow you to look at the implications of a similar pay award.
So we've not done that modelling based on pay award. As John's alluded to earlier, what we have modelled within our financial modelling are, and this is just financial modelling, are a 5% pay award for this year across all staff groups that we've modelled. We've modelled that again for next year, and then that pay award moving back down to 2% for the years thereafter. And that's an indication of where we think inflation may track. And that's how we have got to that overall figure of £29 to £43 million by the end of the resource spending review period. What I can tell you is, if we were to translate that into whole-time firefighter numbers proportionately to how much we spend on operational costs, it would equate to approximately 780 whole-time firefighter posts. That would be the proportionate reduction. Now, that's essentially between 20 and 25% of our whole-time firefighter workforce. That's simply modelling that's been done, and if we applied it proportionately across the whole organisation, that's the scale of the numbers that we would be talking about across that period.
Thank you. That's helpful. Katie, did you want to come in on this?
It was on the issue of pay. I mean, the Fire Brigade Union are lobbying the Parliament tomorrow, and as you'll know, they're currently having a consultative ballot on the 5% pay offer, and the recommendation is for a rejection of that 5%. And the case they make, as I'm sure you're well aware, is that they've received year-on-year real terms pay cuts for 15 years. And over the last decade, there's been significant, job cuts as well. And we all know the inflation rates. So it's not that they've got a bad case or an unreasonable case. So how are you going to make decisions about that? How is it? Is there going to be the Cabinet Secretary involved in that? Or how will you make decisions about how you deal with this pay issue? Because it clearly is a massive issue for the people that you employ.
Yeah, so thanks for that. You're right. We've got different negotiation mechanisms for different staff groups within the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. I'll start with support staff. For support staff, we negotiate directly with the support staff unions, which are Unison and Unite, for support staff pay awards. And we made them a 5% offer, which is currently out for ballot at the moment. And support staff unions have recommended acceptance as the best negotiated package to their members. We're expecting that ballot to close imminently, so we will know the outcome of that ballot for support staff. In terms of uniform staff, That's negotiated through the National Joint Council for Local Authority Fire and Rescue Services at a UK national level. So while we have a seat at the NGIC table, it's not entirely within the gift of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service in terms of what that pay offer is, because that's done at a UK national level. The original offer that was made back in June was 2%, which was purely based on affordability of services across the UK. We then engaged with Scottish Government. We produced a business case for Scottish Government, and they increased our funding for this year in order to be able to support us through the NGIC being able to make a 5% offer. So that 5% offer has been made now at a UK national level. You're right that the Fire Brigade Union Executive Council has rejected that offer, and they're going to ballot, which starts on Monday, recommending to their members to reject that offer. But it would be inappropriate for me to comment in terms of anything else in relation to that particular negotiation while there's a ballot that's about to take place, that's about to commence on Monday.
Perhaps if we could be kept advised in relation to this issue, because it's obviously that would be helpful.
Certainly.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, I'm just going to open up questions to members now, and I'm going to bring in Jamie to begin with, and then I'll bring in Russell Finlay. Jamie.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Just. Gentlemen, I've listened to what you said carefully about it's not as easy with your service to equate reductions in budget to reductions in headcount due to the nature of the roles that people have and the types of contracts they have. But for the purpose of budget scrutiny, we will have to perform some type of analysis. So maybe we could work on a full-time equivalent type arrangement, which is not necessarily equivalent to how you operate, but it certainly gives us an ability to equate people and numbers. So if the proposed budget comes to fruition as a budget rather than as a forecast warning, could you try and help us quantify this in terms of people, frontline people? Because I think what the public are probably most interested in is how many firefighters will be available, how many stations will remain open or have to close, how many fewer vehicles will be there to service, how many crew will be on a particular job or call out. And so it's that frontline service. I'm really keen to dig below the surface. What would that mean to frontline firefighting in Scotland if this came to pass?
Yeah, so the figure that I gave you earlier, if we applied the reductions that we will need to make across our budget proportionately across all parts of the organisation, then that would equate to approximately 780 full-time firefighter posts at the moment. So that's essentially the 64% of the budget that we currently goes on operational frontline staff costs, would equate to roughly about 780 full-time firefighter posts. And that probably equates roughly to about 30 full-time fire appliances. We currently have within the service 116 full-time fire appliances, and we've also got 345 on-call appliances as well. So that gives you an order of magnitude that we would be talking about probably if we were to apply the savings proportionally across the organisation, we would probably be talking about 25% of the whole time firefighting establishment that would not become affordable by the end of the 4-year period.
Right. So even on a flat cash settlement, does that include, or have you factored in a pay rise or not? Does that include a percentage pay rise in that calculation?
So the modelling, so that's based on the £43 million, which is the higher end of our modelling, and that modelling is based on a 5% pay rise for 22-23,
okay.
A 5% pay rise for 23-24, and then a 2% pay rise thereafter across the remainder of the resource spending review period. So those are the pay rises that we have factored in for modelling purposes only. And clearly, as John has already alluded to, those pay rises, whether it's either directly with support staff, unions for support staff, or through the National Joint Council, those pay rises are negotiated on an annual basis. Mm-hmm. But those are the numbers that we have factored in to our model for financial and financial modelling purposes.
Okay, so on the modelling of a potential 5% pay rise annual for the next couple of years, which, as we already know, sounds like it's been rejected at this stage, so it could be more. And the flat cash settlement, you'd be looking at an equivalent reduction of over 780 full-time equivalent firefighters and around 30 full-time appliances out of 120. That's quite a big reduction. What are the consequences of that?
So, what we are doing at the moment is we're doing modelling. We've got our community risk index model, which is a GIS system that we've got, that we have plugged a lot of data into. We've plugged our historical incident activity data into it, because although where incidents haven't occurred in the past necessarily says where they'll occur in the future, it gives us a good approximation of risk across the country in terms of where we've got a predominance of certain incident types. We have also looked at population data, so we've used the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, we've used software systems such as Mosaic, so we've got a really good understanding of risk across Scotland. We are then able to overlay our current disposition of resources against that risk map, and then we can understand from that modelling what specific impacts would be of either changing duty patterns at a particular location, or removing appliances, or closing stations at particular locations. Now, we will always do that on a risk-assessed basis, and we will always do that on in a way to try and minimise the impacts upon community and firefighter safety as best we can. But ultimately, if the flat cash settlement turns into budget reality, and as I've already said, it will undoubtedly impact upon frontline firefighter numbers, then that will undoubtedly increase across the piece in particular areas where we make changes, things like response times to incidents, potentially the initial speed and weight of response to incidents. That's an inevitability. We will undertake specific impact assessments at a local level on those specific local proposals that we would make for change. We would engage with stakeholders, we would consult with stakeholders on that, we would always seek to minimise that, but ultimately, if we are to change our crewing arrangements, as I've outlined, or we are to remove resources, it would ultimately impact upon our response times, but we will always benchmark that and provide information to communities to benchmark that against our median response times, so we understand how that will impact against our median response times across Scotland.
That's quite a jargon-filled response, and I understand the reason for that, but I think what we're looking for in the committee, as you've heard from the last session from Frontline Services, some candour. You know, what does this mean in layman's terms for people? Are we talking about delays to responses, you know, prioritising call-outs, the closure of stations, incidents not being responded to? You know, what does it actually mean to the general public? Because they're the ones that are worried and concerned about it.
Absolutely. Apologies if I used jargon. It was unintentional. Essentially, what I'd outlined earlier is more, very rarely within the Fire and Rescue Service do we, so we always respond to every emergency within Scotland that we're called out to. Very rarely do we not send an immediate response to an incident. We tend to do it when we experience spate conditions. So if we've got particular storm conditions, we're about to approach the bonfire season, we tend to have to start calls at times like that, because the demand outweighs our capacity. But generally speaking, we don't delay response. So we wouldn't anticipate being in a position where we are delaying a response and stacking calls and not responding to calls immediately, other than those situations. But what it would mean is that it may be that the attendance time for appliances, because there is a lesser disposition of appliances, or we might be moving from some appliances that are currently crewed on a full-time basis to be crewed by on-call firefighters, and there's a natural delay for on-call firefighters to arrive at the station. So generally speaking, across the piece, we would expect our attendance times to incidents to increase proportionately to how much resource we have to remove from service.
Thank you, that's helpful. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Can I, just before I bring Russell Finlay in, just on this issue about having, you know, choices around where you make these cuts and how you configure that across your service provision. So we know, for example, that during COVID, fire death numbers increased. And there was perhaps a correlation, I think I'm right in saying that there was a correlation between that and areas of deprivation. So does that mean that you would have to think carefully and maybe even use modelling or data to inform in a geographical context where and how you make those cuts? I hope I'm not straying too much off budget, but I think it's maybe important, as Jamie was saying, in terms of public confidence, how those cuts might be, how they might look.
Yeah, so you're absolutely right that there are links between deprivation and vulnerability and susceptibility to all manner of unintentional harm, including fire. And as I mentioned earlier, we've got our community risk index model that gives us a good indication at the moment of what population risk looks like across Scotland. We're adding to that at the moment as well to look at physical risks such as flooding risks, wildfire risks and things like that. So we've got a good understanding of risk across Scotland, and any decisions that we make will always be made with a view to minimising the impacts upon community safety as best we can. So it will absolutely be risk assessed, and any significant changes we make will be subject to their own impact assessments and will be subject to full stakeholder consultation and engagement as well.
Thanks very much indeed. I'll bring in Russell Finlay and then I'll bring in Runa Mackay after that. Russell.
Thank you very much. I think, first of all, it's good to see senior officers here today. I think firefighters and the public will be grateful for that. And I've been really quite taken aback by some of the figures. You know, you don't really imagine that it costs £1 million to effectively crew a single fire appliance 24 hours, 365 days a year. And obviously you face some very tough choices. There's one quick question I'd like to pick up on something Mr. Thompson raised, and that was the inability to hold reserves. It might be academic in the short term, given the budgets, but is that something that can be fixed or something you've addressed with the government?
It's something that we are seeking to understand. I guess when we were going back in history in 2013, when we were in local, prior to that, we were local authority based, and we had the reserves and the ability to hold reserves. When we became a single service, we no longer have the ability to borrow, and also we don't have the ability to hold reserves. So that's why I was making that point. And I guess the point of reserves is more around it can help smooth any delivery, especially when we're talking about any potential changes in crewing models or stations. It helps smooth the overall position, but ultimately we would have to work with government and say, look, here's our savings plans. It might be a bit lumpy. Can you help and support us effectively acting as a reserve?
Is there any discussion about having that ability?
That ability.
No. Okay. Right. Now, more generally, you also mentioned, I think, 23 scenarios that have been modelled, which sounds like the equivalent of wandering through a smoke-filled room. Now, these presumably are one extreme to the other, and everything in between. Do they include worst-case scenario things like ending the policy and no compulsory redundancies, or is that off the table?
We are following government policy, and that is no compulsory redundancy. So I guess to highlight there, for the fastest you can go in terms of pace, is linked to the retirees and the number of people that are leaving the organisation.
So that particular policy is set in stone as far as the service is concerned?
That's my understanding.
Right. I think from my perspective, the no compulsory redundancy policy that's a Scottish Government policy that the service supports, I think, is of great comfort to our staff. I think it provides our staff, not just within the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, but across the public sector, with a great deal of reassurance. And it's certainly not something that, clearly, if it's a policy decision for Scottish Government, that's up to Scottish Government, but it's certainly not something within the service that I would advocate for, because I think it gives a great deal of reassurance and comfort and security to our staff.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Rona Mackay, and then I think Jamie Green might be wanting to come back in.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Good afternoon. Just a quick question for John. First of all, has there been any financial planning done on the fact that, you know, it's been mentioned that possibly community stations might need to close, etc., subject to risk assessment? Has there been any planning done on what revenue that could bring in if you were able to sell those premises? If is that within your ownership, you know, what could be brought in from that, what could be gained?
Yeah, I suppose the reality is we have not identified specific stations at this stage, and what we have probably looked at is more in a general context. Well, what would that mean in terms of number of stations? What would that mean in terms of crewing models, etc.? It's not until you get to the specifics of what's...
But there would be revenue be able to come in from that.
Absolutely. So just to put it in context, and Ross mentioned that there was that single pump costs, single pump station costs us about £1 million. Typically, 80% of that is the cost. In fact, maybe slightly more. I better check my numbers. But there is then a property running cost, and yes, we would be able to save those costs going forward, and also potentially realise a capital receipt, which would help us from our backlog in terms of capital investment. And we've highlighted the fact that we have a growing backlog of capital investment. Our capital backlog at the moment is just over £492 million.
Okay, thank you. That's useful to know. I'm going to ask a question which I appreciate is probably difficult to answer, but from everything that's been said, and, you know, if cuts need to be made in the way that you're describing, what area would be impacted most, do you think, just in a general sense, if you had to make certain cuts?
Are you talking the area of the organisation or geographical area?
Operational, really, just, yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah, so, I mean, as I mentioned, we would always try and protect our frontline operational resources, but similarly to Police Scotland, we've been on a journey of reform as well for the past 10 years, and that's probably resulted in us removing something in the order of about £482 million out of the cost base of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service over the past 10 years. So that's if you basically take our budget over that period and compare it with legacy service budgets, if they had been subject to inflation over that time period. What that's resulted in is us being an extremely lean organisation. So while we will always seek to make savings across the whole of the organisation, we're a very lean organisation. We've got pretty lean back office functions. Police Scotland spoke earlier about seeking opportunities for shared services and collaboration, and we're absolutely seeking those opportunities with Police Scotland, Scottish Ambulance Service and other partners. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, because we're quite a lean organisation already in those areas, it's quite difficult to make substantial savings there. So there will be quite an impact on our frontline operational resources, because we don't have the ability to make any significant savings from elsewhere within the organisation. Because of the nature of our operational, we spoke earlier about whole-time resources, so full-time resources, which are predominantly in more urban areas across the central belt of Scotland. Whole-time resources, because we are employing people on a full-time basis,
take up more of our budget than on-call resources, where we pay people, I mean, on-call firefighters provide fantastic services to their communities, but they're paid a retaining fee and then paid for training and to attend incidents and things like that. So it's a less expensive model. So when we look for substantial savings to be made, unfortunately, where we can make those savings is more from the whole time elements of our service than from the on-call elements of our service.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Fulton, do you want to ask a follow-up to this?
Yeah, it's on this point. Thanks a lot. I've got some questions later, but one of the questions that I've got actually follows on directly from Rona. I should say good afternoon as well. So thanks to the convener for allowing me to come in. When you're talking about the on-call crew, and I know that your submission, and you've spoken about this, has already said that house stations are crewed as a possibility. And this is something that even before the current situation we find ourselves in, I had actually some queries about, and I've done a wee bit of work around the Coat Dyke or Coat Bridge fire station around the crewing situation. And you've already answered Ronan Mackay there, but I wonder, the on-call service sounds like a really helpful thing, the fire service, but what difficulties does that bring? What risks is associated with that? Because that's certainly what I've heard from those who are at is it a less responsive service? Does it come with a greater risk of something going wrong?
Good afternoon, committee. The on-call colleagues provide an exceptional level of service across Scotland, particularly in our remote rural communities. But it's an old model, and it is increasingly difficult for us to resource that model. There's a number of societal changes that are reflected across the world in terms of provision of on-call staff. Migration of staff from rural areas to urbanised areas reduces the ability to recruit from those communities. So we've got a huge amount of work going at the moment to try and bolster our on-call programme. We've got a programme of work that looks to improve the attraction and retention of on-call staff, but it's not without its challenges. And as I say, we're doing a lot of work around about that. We also have our youth engagement scheme that we're rolling out across Scotland at the moment. And we see that as a pathway for young people to form an interest in the service, join the on-call, and hopefully a pathway into the whole time as well to try and bolster that on-call. But the on-call is and remains a challenge, not just for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, but for all services across the world, as I say.
OK. Thanks very much. And that does save one of my questions later on. Thank you.
Thanks very much. OK, I'll bring in Jamie Green, and then I'll bring in Colette Stevenson.
Hopefully I'll open up Colette's line of questioning in more detail, but I just wanted to kick it off with obviously we're looking at the budget forecast, so flat cash settlement for the next couple of years, which obviously will present challenges, as you've indicated. But is it fair to say that even before that announcement, we still had problems with funding and cash settlements? My understanding is that as far back as 2018, Audit Scotland identified a huge backlog of capital investment in the service, which I presume results from years of capital underinvestment. So where were we at before we got to where we are today? Because surely, you know, it's all very well looking ahead at what you might need to cut now if these budgets come to pass. But even if these budgets don't come to pass, even if you are offered more cash, capital or resource by the government, and you're not in the scenario planning that you've identified today, that doesn't address the issue of the huge backlog of capital investment, which, as we know, clearly puts the health, well-being and safety of firefighters into jeopardy, given some of the stories that we've heard in the media in recent months. Where were we at up until now, and how did we get to that point? Why were things so bad in the first place?
Yeah, so thanks very much, Mr. Green. You're right that we do have Audit Scotland back in 2018 described our capital backlog as insurmountable. Because of what Audit Scotland said at the time was we needed a sustained period of about 3 years of having approximately £80 million invested within our capital, and then it would be able to drop off to about £50 million £5 million. However, clearly we've not had capital allocations of that magnitude. Our current capital allocation is £32.5 million per annum. And as John mentioned earlier, the spending power of that at the moment is a lot less than it was even 12 months ago. We heard John speaking earlier about 30% inflation in construction costs and things like that at the moment. We undertook earlier on, towards the end of last year, last calendar year into this year, we undertook a risk-based assessment of our capital needs. And our capital needs essentially cover our community fire stations, our vehicle fleet and our equipment. And our assessment was that we had almost a £500 million backlog in terms of our capital at that time. And our assessment was that we would need to invest £63 million per annum for the next 10 years in our capital in order to make good that particular deficit. But as you say, that's through decades worth of insufficient investment within our capital portfolio. And it's within our submission, the most pressing concern that we've got is that we've got 14 stations at the moment that have got a construction method, reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete, 14 stations which essentially, we've taken remedial action to safeguard them at the moment, but essentially in the long term will require these stations to effectively be rebuilt. And that would be to a cost, well, based on previous estimated costs, that would be to a cost of about £70 million. Clearly, that would be increasing with the current inflationary pressure. So those stations alone that need to be replaced because of a safety concern with the previous construction methods would cost us £70 million alone. So real concerns, and we're very much taking a risk-based approach to how we invest our capital money at the moment, because it's insufficient to meet our needs.
I mean, quite literally, we did not fix the roof while the sun was shining. In some cases, the roofs have fallen down in fire stations. I mean, that must present a huge challenge and risk. 14 stations is a lot to not be in satisfactory condition. It's no wonder the unions are up in arms over this. It sounds unacceptable to working conditions for some, but £500 million is a lot of cash backlogged. And that's when inflation was low, when construction costs were low, and when budgets were going up. And now we're staring in the face of the opposite at the moment. It seems very unlikely that you'll ever get that amount of money. You know, if you weren't getting what you asked for when times were good, how are you going to get £62 million when times are tough? What would your request to the government be, given what we're talking about today in terms of cash budgets?
So in terms of we believe our requirement for capital per annum is £63 million. So that's what we believe we require based on our risk-based assessment of our current estate, our current fleet of vehicles and our current equipment. We are always seeking to make improvements to our vehicles and to our equipment, whether that be to support our low carbon initiatives or whether it's to improve community and firefighter safety. So for example, over the last couple of years we have replaced all of our hydraulic rescue equipment, mm-hmm. which have petrol driven generators and hydraulic hoses with battery operated equipment, which is better for the environment, safer for firefighters and safer for members of the public when we're using that equipment. That costs us something in the order of about £4 million. It's extremely difficult for us to make those improvements while the existing capital budget that we've got is being used to make good properties and things like that. One thing that we are doing, and Police Scotland spoke about it earlier, is we are, wherever possible, collaborating with Police Scotland, Scottish Ambulance Service and other partners. We have just over 50 of our stations that we have also got either ambulance or Police yep. Scotland or another
partner. I live across the road from one.
utilising. So we take these collaborative opportunities. And it's not we're not just doing that in terms of our frontline operational premises. We're also doing that for our corporate buildings as well. The way that people have work now is vastly different to 3 years ago. We've got an agile working policy for all of our support staff or those staff that don't need to come into the workplace on a daily basis. So we are currently reviewing our corporate building requirements based on the fact that people are working more agilely at the moment. And we're doing that with partners so that we can make better use of our partner properties from a non-operational perspective as well. So we are doing all that we can in order to ameliorate some of the problems we've got ourselves, but ultimately we do still require significant capital investments within the organisation.
Can I just bring in Russell? I think you're a very quick follow-up.
That's okay. Well, it's kind of connected, but it's a couple of questions, so if you want to go first, sorry.
Colette, and then I'll bring you in, Russell.
Okay, thanks very much. Good afternoon. And obviously, based on what Jamie asked you, and notwithstanding the basic backlog that you are dealing with in terms of capital, obviously that flat cash settlement is going to have an impact, obviously, on the fire service in terms of your ability to put more investment into the likes of your estate, as you've touched upon, the fleet as well, and improving digital IT and whatnot as well. So I was just wondering if you can give more detail in terms of the significant impact that it will be, and also the particular risks as well involved in areas because you're not upgrading and because you're not improving current systems.
So if I can take that in two aspects, first of all the resource budget aspect. So we've already spoken about potential impacts on frontline service delivery. It's also very difficult. Quite a lot of new initiatives, particularly those that require new ways of working, new IT systems. We've got some quite ageing IT systems. A lot of those systems that can make organisations operate more efficiently and effectively require some upfront investment. So it's difficult for us to have resources to be able to make investments that can make improvements, that can make subsequent efficiencies within the organisation from a resource perspective. So we are currently looking at all of our major change projects at the moment and reviewing their viability going forward, because we may not be able to invest as much as we would like to within them. From a capital perspective, as I've already mentioned, we've got quite a significant capital backlog, and basically we are having to use the money we've got to, pardon the expression, but make do and mend within stations rather than actually improving our portfolio of properties, making them, we have been able to invest approximately £10 million over the past few years in sort of green ways of working, whether it's appliances, whether it's on stations, but that's reliant upon additional ring-fenced money from Scottish Government, which is very welcomed, but we can't make those sorts of improvements within our core capital budget. We've also got concerns regarding dignified facilities for all staff and visitors to a number of our premises across Scotland, and we've also got concerns that are starting to become more apparent in terms of occupational cancer associated with firefighting and the ability for firefighters to be able to appropriately decontaminate within our premises when they come back from incidents and things like that. So it's not just, we don't just require capital investment to be able to maintain what we've currently got because of a lack of dignified facilities within some of our premises, because of a lack of ability for firefighters to clean themselves properly when they come back from incidents, that makes it necessary for us to be upgrading our existing premises, never mind just maintaining the existing premises in the existing condition. So those are all things that we would love to be able to invest more money in, but it becomes more challenging when we've got such a challenge across our capital budget.
Can I just come in on that in terms of, you touched upon it as well, John, was the fact that you don't have the ability to borrow. But in terms of the capital backlog, and back to that, is have you got the ability to lease rather than capital, you know, outright purchase? In which case it would be shown on your balance sheet as a completely different, you know, rather, you know, it would be a revenue rather than capital as such.
Yeah, yes, so we could undertake a kind of lease or a purchase arrangement. However, there's also a change in the accounting standards around that, which means that it then becomes part of your balance sheet and we have to have the capital to cover it. So even though it's actually a purchase or is done through a lease, it would effectively be capitalised and it would have the same impact. It would just have to be funded through our capital programme.
But it would probably lengthen your capital, you know, in terms of your budget going forward.
Yeah, but you have to capitalise the whole life cycle of the actual lease period, and that would then be represented on your balance sheet, and we would have to undertake it. So, in essence, what I'm really saying in a cumbersome accounting way, it makes no real difference whether we lease or purchase in terms of the impact on our capital funding, effectively.
Thank you. Okay, thanks very much. I'm just mindful of the time, and I've got some other members wanting to come in on this topic of discussion. So I'm going to bring in Katie, because I don't think you've asked any questions yet of our fire service panel. And then I'm going to bring in Pauline, and if there's time, I'll bring yourself in, Russell. So Katie first.
Yes, and I wanted to sort of pick up on the issue about the extensive research there now is on the carcinogenic effect of fire particles and some of the implications for the estate, and indeed some of the legal implications for the fire service and the duty of care that you have towards the people that you employ. And my understanding is that there are significant numbers of stations where there isn't adequate showering or toileting. I know you've referred to this, or indeed even a sort of proper fresh water supply. Can you maybe give us more detail about that? And as I say, I think there are legal obligations and in terms of your duty of care towards staff, and as more information becomes available, and I understand a lot of work's been done abroad, a lot of research is now available that shows there is a significant link between exposure to fire particles and various forms of cancer. So is that something maybe you could expand on in terms of the needs to upgrade the estate that you have now?
So the first thing, and probably the most important thing, is it's an issue that we take extremely seriously within the organisation. We've got a contaminants working group that we've created to look at this particular issue, and we're working very closely with the Fire Brigades Union on this particular issue. Indeed, we've got some sessions next week where one of the foremost academics in this field is coming to Scotland. I think she's visiting. She's certainly visiting us. I think she's visiting the Parliament next week as well, sponsored by the Fire Brigade Union, and we're very supportive of that work. What we have done to date is we have audited all of our stations, so we understand what the current picture is in terms of our ability to enable firefighters to decontaminate appropriately when they come back to station. In some cases, that is a combination of technical solutions on stations, but also practical application, one-way systems and things like that. So we're looking at all of our premises and how we can devise something that's appropriate to each premises. You're right, we do have a small number of stations that don't have running water at them, and we have got specialist decontamination wipes that we provide to those stations so that firefighters can undertake decontamination when they come back from station. So it is an area that is of a real priority for us. We're doing a lot of work in this regard, a lot more to do, but we absolutely see it as a priority and are working very closely with the Fire Brigade Union on it.
I've been told that there's over 100 stations where there isn't sufficient showering or toileting. Do you think that is correct? And are you able to come forward with a cost of what the resource implication is to undertake this upgrade work for these specific reasons?
Yeah, it's not a figure that I would disagree with in terms of that number of stations. We do have individual costs for those elements. Mm-hmm. However, all of that is when we talk about our current assessment of £630 million backlog on our capital, all of those are taken into account within that. So we do have individual figures for those individual elements. I don't have them to hand, but please be assured that all of those issues are wrapped up within the overall risk-assessed approach we are taking to our capital investment and is included within that £630 million.
Would you agree that that work has to be a priority? Obviously, I'm sure there's a whole range of upgrading work that ideally would want to take place on the estate, but this particular work has to be a priority. And in terms of capital spend, it would be useful to get as much information on that as possible in terms of this particular, you know, tranche of work that is necessary for the reasons given.
Yeah, I would certainly wholeheartedly agree that it's a priority, and more than happy to provide some additional detail to the committee if that would assist.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to bring in Pauline McNeill. Pauline.
Good afternoon to the panel. I just wanted to go back very briefly to the issue of pay. And you told my colleague Katie Clark that the pay negotiations were obviously taking place at the NGIC at national level. And so there's talk of a 5% pay increase. And Katie Clark already said that it looks like that's likely to be rejected. But what I wanted to ask you was, if a figure is arrived at by the NGC, whether it's 5, 6 or whatever that percentage is, do you simply have to implement that figure if the NGC make that decision and that comes off your existing budget? So I know you said you've got a seat round the table on that, but essentially that, you know, decision could be made in the national forum that could be a figure that you would just have to implement regardless of what that was, right?
Yeah, so whatever the NGIC agrees. Now, the NGIC is a group that is made up of employers and employee representatives. The employee representatives on the NGIC negotiating body is made up of the Fire Brigade Union, and then there are employer representatives from across the UK, of which Scotland has a seat on that group. However, to answer your question very simply, yes, if there is an NGIC pay rise that's agreed upon, then that would be implemented within Scotland.
Thank you. And just finally, we've heard sort of similar evidence from the police service that there are virtually no more savings that can be made. Transformational change and moving to a single service has used up a lot of that room. I think you said something similar. It sounds like we're hearing almost comparable evidence from the fire service and the police service in relation to, well, there's nowhere else to go. But my question is, do you have concerns that we might lose fire service officers from the front line if there's no proper pay, a settlement that would be satisfactory? Do you have any concerns about retaining firefighters in the long run?
We always seek to appropriately reward our staff and retain staff. Our staff provide excellent services to communities across Scotland on a daily basis. So we always seek to retain our staff who are highly valued by the organisation. We have got similar challenges to Police Scotland in terms of recent changes to pensions, and that has led to a number of our staff retiring earlier than we had previously anticipated, and indeed it becomes more, one of the other challenges we face is it becomes more difficult now with the changes to the pensions to accurately predict when people are likely to retire. So traditionally people have effectively retired at a certain age or after 30 years service, but that's now become a bit more nuanced, so it's difficult to predict retirement rates, and that has an impact upon workforce planning across the piece. So we've got similar challenges in terms of that. We do have people who will leave the organisation as well out with retirement. But thankfully, although that occurs, those numbers tend to be fairly low. So most of the people leaving the organisation and taking a lot of years of knowledge and experience with them, normally that's through retirement. But as I say, that's becoming more difficult to predict and challenging to manage just because of the recent changes to, as Mr Page said earlier, just the recent changes to the commutation factors associated with firefighter pension schemes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Pauline. I think, John, you want to just come in on that?
Not on that point. It's actually just to pick up on the point Katie Clark mentioned. It was just to give you a wee bit of clarity around the figure. It's £138 million. We describe it as suitability of our station. So there's the asset condition of our station, and then there's the suitability of our station. So we obviously have to prioritise on the asset condition, but we also have to consider the suitability of it, and that's where for contaminants. So the actual figure that we believe that we is £138 million for that area. I just couldn't find it quick enough in my paper.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to bring in Fulton before I bring in Russell, just to bring our session to a close. So Fulton.
Thanks, convener. I think the sirens were there for the purpose of the committee. So I had a few questions, but they've actually been some of them have been covered. As I said, I've already asked a supplementary earlier, and I had a question around Audit Scotland report in the 14 stations with serious structural safety issues. But colleagues have covered them, so in the interest of time, I can just move on. And so the only question I've got is one that. You might have heard me ask the police service in the last session, and that's around joint up working. If there's a flat cash settlement for all the services, you are all integrated, you all work together. What's your thoughts and what's your planning around how that's going to pan out? Do you see it as a situation? I think what the police were saying earlier was that they expect that a lot of the time when other services, including yourselves and other justice partners, struggle, they're left to pick up perhaps in areas where they wouldn't normally. Is that how you would see it going? Would it be the police, or would you see it actually as yourselves would pick up from the police in some areas? And just some general thoughts on that.
So there's probably two things I would say in relation to that, Mr McGregor. The first is in terms of collaborative working. Mr Page from Police Scotland earlier mentioned the Blue Light Collaboration Board, which sits underneath the Reform Collaboration Group, which was formed back in 2013 when the police fire reform took place, and also includes the Scottish Ambulance Service. So we're looking at a whole host of collaborative opportunities to work with partners so that we can mutually look to savings that we might need to make over this period and work collaboratively with one another, whether that's shared premises, whether it's shared services for back office functions. We're looking at all those sorts of things. What we'd also say is... We believe that the Fire and Rescue Service and our firefighters can do more for communities across Scotland. Members might be aware that we've been in discussions with the... Over a number of years, we've been in discussions with the Fire Brigade Union, both at a UK national level, but more recently, specifically, within Scotland, in relation to developing the role of our firefighters within Scotland. We've had very fruitful discussions with the Fire Brigades Union, where we have reached a kind of a mutually agreeable proposal between the service and the Fire Brigades Union on what a developed role for firefighters could be going forwards. And we believe that by developing the role of firefighters, both in terms of the types of emergencies that our firefighters attend, but also equally importantly, the broadening the preventative role of firefighters, because our frontline firefighters, as well as having a response role, have a very important prevention role to play as well. We believe that by developing the role of firefighters, we can make additional benefits for communities. We can improve a broader range of outcomes for communities, and we believe the positivity from that can resonate across the whole of the public service, not just within the Fire and Rescue Service or the Justice portfolio. So we believe that investing in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, developing the role of our firefighters, appropriately remunerating firefighters and having terms and conditions that reflect that would be of great benefit to communities and the public sector more broadly as well.
I really welcome all that. I think that's a fantastic piece of work, and I think that you know, the Blue Light collaboration is spoke about by both yourself and the police earlier, I think is great and should be happening. I guess what I'm asking in terms of the budget scrutiny is, and it might be that you're not able to look at this, but is part of your own analysis and your own assessments looking at how other services might be cut, or do you just have to leave that to the side, you know, and not concentrate on that in case, you know, maybe will the police get an increase or whatever? Or do you sit and, or do you sit and say, look, the police might be getting caught here, this is how it's going to impact us?
Yeah, so as I say, we're doing that through the Blue Light Collaboration just Board, where we're looking at, I think there's about 9 different thematic areas that we're looking at between ourselves, police and the Scottish Ambulance Service, right, in terms of how we can look, particularly across our corporate functions, in terms of how we can collaborate, work together, so that we can, and as Mr Page said earlier, it may well be that one of the services can make a saving by using services of another service, yeah, but across the piece we can balance that out. So we're absolutely looking at how we can work together in order to take a partnership approach to collectively looking at the savings that we need to make going forward.
So what progress, thanks very much. Convener, I do have one other very quick supplementary question that's actually just came to me as I've been speaking throughout the course of the committee, and that's about the impact of climate change. Now, the reason why I'm asking this today is throughout this committee today, I'm getting a sun at the bottom of my screen here saying 16 degrees, and at certain points today it's actually said it's a record temperature now, but in nearly November, 16 degrees Celsius. That's it, it's turned red now, it must be listening to me. Temperature record. So what impact, when you're thinking about your budget going ahead now, obviously today is maybe not the best sample, but the summer there we had, scorching, you know, yous must have been really busy at that point. Is that something, is climate change something that you're actually filtering in to your budgets and your requests to Scottish Government?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, the Chief talked there around about our ambitions moving forward to broaden and expand the role of firefighters in Scotland. Part of that is that the inevitable response to climate change is going to increase. And as you say, we've seen over the last few years, one-off incidents of flooding, of wildfires are becoming much more frequent. So we've invested heavily in a wildfire strategy, and we've invested in specialist water rescue teams. But part of the discussions that we're having with the FBU in terms of an expanded role would allow us to expand that capability across Scotland to meet the challenges that will inevitably come of climate change. So yes, we're absolutely focused on that. But again, that requires investment for us to meet that demand.
Thanks very much. I know that some of that was referred to earlier as well. Thanks. That's convenient.
Okay,
thanks
very
for
much.
Giving me that extra question.
Finally, Russell.
Two very, very quick and specific questions about capital. One to do with buildings, one to do with vehicles. Buildings, you're talking about 14 needing rebuilt at a cost of £70 million. I understand right now there's a building that's gone significantly over budget in the region of something like £4 million to £14 million. I don't know if you recognise that. And if you do, whether indeed a £70 million budget for 14 new stations is therefore in any way realistic.
I'll probably ask John to talk about the specifics regarding the 70 million and how realistic that is for those buildings.
First of all, the overrun on the one that's happening just now, is that recognised?
I don't have the specific McDonald Road,
I'm presuming you're
I don't know actually.
I think it is.
The figures were 4 to 14 approximately.
The cost increase.
The cost was about 15 million. Pounds in terms of McDonald Road, and that's not just a station, that also included a museum element to it as well, and it's obviously a wider facility, community facility, and that was part and parcel of some of the things that we talked around the construction inflation cost, you know, that we had to, there's a number of issues with McDonald Road.
It was 4 million.
No. The original building was never £4 million for McDonald Road, not that I'm aware of.
But approximately, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Would it possibly be helpful to maybe follow that up in writing?
Yeah,
to
move on to the
vehicle
question. That's fine, thank you. So the vehicles, you've got a fleet of electric vehicles, cars. Now, my understanding is they've perhaps not been as used as well as they might
might have been due to the practicalities of charging and so on. I also see you've just taken possession of an electric fire engine, which was on your Twitter feed. Has that been bought, first of all, the cost of that, and second of all, has it been bought primarily for the practical purpose it can serve, or has it, the decision been significantly influenced around environmental considerations? And if so, is it the right vehicle for the job?
So I'll answer the question. I'm not sure about I'll pass over to John in a moment for the electric vehicle fleet generally. I can speak about the electrical fire appliance. It's effectively what we have done. It's a prototype appliance, although we've purchased it, and it's effectively got exactly the same operational capabilities of a traditional fire appliance. It would have an internal combustion engine, but the propulsion mechanism is different. Clearly, there's a range in terms of how far it can go. There's an amount of time it can pump for at an instant and things like that that might be different. But in terms of its frontline operational capabilities, it's the same as a traditional fire appliance. We were able to procure it with assistance from Transport Scotland, and it's very much a prototype to see how that type of technology could work within the fire and rescue sector.
And it's in use just now?
It's not in use at the moment. It will be deployed to Cambus Lang Community Fire Station once it's in operational service. So it's not actually on the run just now. It's been built, and I think it's with our training department at the moment.
And this is a bit left field, but the photograph of it from the front shows a giant. It's blue and white. It's a Saltire. If that was coming up behind a vehicle, it looks more like a haulage vehicle than a fire engine.
That wrap will be removed
right
once it goes operational, and it will look like any other fire appliance once it's operational.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. John?
Just to come back on the figures, it was £660,000 was the kind of tender price around the electric appliance, and we received a grant from Scottish Government of £500,000. In relation to that, we've also received additional grant to support the infrastructure, because being a fairly significant electric appliance, it requires a higher charge feed. So there's been some additional grant given to us for that infrastructure as well.
£660,000 for a first fire engine. How much would one normally cost?
Oh, I think it's under the £500,000.
Right, so it's more but not double or anything. Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much for attending. I wonder if I can just maybe finish off, just to follow up from Russell Finlay's questions about the faulty RAAC panels, and maybe just ask if there can be any follow-up information on that and the potential closure of stations around that and what the implications are for that. So that would be very helpful indeed. So again, thank you very much for your attendance today, and we'll just have a short suspension to allow our witnesses to leave. Thank you.
Thank you, members. Our next item of business today is to discuss recent correspondence that the committee has received, and I refer members to paper number 5. So the clerks have suggested some ideas of how we may want to take forward the various issues, but ultimately that's for us to decide if we decide differently. So I'll take each of the letters in turn now. And firstly, the letter from Police Scotland on the use of cyber kiosks. Does anybody, any members have anything to raise, or are we content to agree to the recommendations made? Happy? Okay. Thank you very much. And the secondly, the letter from the Scottish Prison Service on purposeful activity. Any member want to?
It was to do with the two prisons that are under SPS control. Mm-hmm. They are not addressed. I just wonder whether we need to seek that from those operators. Okay. Same information.
So maybe you want to write for some clarification on that?
Yeah, very well. Okay. Come on.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. If there's no other points that members wish to raise, then that completes our public business for today. Our next meeting will be on Wednesday, the 2nd of November, when we'll continue taking evidence as part of our pre-budget scrutiny process. And as previously agreed, we'll now move into private session. Thank you.